Good morning and welcome to the 21st meeting of the COVID-19 committee. We have received apologies from Beatrice Wishart, MSP, who is attending another parliamentary committee this morning. I welcome Willie Rennie, MSP, to the meeting, who is attending as a substitute. Our meeting will involve two evidence sessions this morning. We will be taking evidence from the Cabinet Secretary for the Constitution, Europe and External Affairs on subordinate legislation until 10:30 a.m. I will then suspend the meeting for up to 15 minutes to allow a changeover of witnesses. The committee will then take evidence from stakeholders on the impact of possible restrictions over winter. May I now turn to agenda item one. The first item on the agenda is to take evidence from the Cabinet Secretary for the Constitution, Europe and External Affairs on the following SSI: the Health Protection Coronavirus Restrictions and Requirements Local Level Scotland Amendment Number 2 Regulations 2020, SSI 2020-374. This SSI gives effect to the restrictions announced by the Minister last Tuesday, announced by the First Minister last Tuesday on the 10th of November, which have now come into force. Cabinet Secretary is accompanied by Professor Jason Leach, National Clinical Director, and I welcome you both to the meeting, and can I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a brief opening statement before we turn to questions.
Thank you, convener, and thank you for the opportunity of discussing these regulations with the committee today. As on my previous occasions at this committee, which have been many and varied, I have to say, of course, I'm open to question, as will Jason Leach be on other issues that arise. The regulations to be discussed today, formally in the agenda, adjust the levels-based approach, which is currently in place across Scotland. The regulations modify some of the restrictions and requirements for the different levels and set out changes to the level that applies to three areas of Scotland. All other areas remain in the same level on these regulations. The areas are Fife, Angus and Perth and Kinross local government areas, and all the three areas move to level three as a result of this legislation. The Scottish Government made regulations by way of made affirmative procedure on the 12th of November, and these regulations entered into force on the 13th of November. Of course, as the First Minister set out to Parliament yesterday, we will be making further changes to the levels that apply in certain areas of Scotland. We intend to bring forward regulations later this week to move the areas outlined yesterday in the First Minister's statement from level three to level four. I think that is a basic explanation of what these regulations are about, but of course, you will want to range more widely, I'm sure, about them.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I'll now turn to questions. Can I ask the first question and ask you about anomalies within local authority areas, for example, where rural areas with low transmission rates are being affected by urban areas with higher transmission rates? Has any further decision been taken about applying a more regional approach within local authority areas? And I ask that especially with regards to the Highlands and Islands and, of course, your own constituency of Argyll and Bute, which is a potential example of such a situation.
Yes, you and I, convener, are both very aware of this issue, particularly in Argyll and Bute. Indeed, you and I are taking part in a discussion with the Islay Resilience Committee on Friday morning about this issue. And clearly, within places like Islay and Hull and in mainland areas of other local authorities, there will be concerns, as there are in mainland areas of Argyll and Bute, about the substantial difference between prevalence in one area and another. I'll ask Jason Leach to say a word or two about this, because we did address it, I think, the last time that we were both at the committee. But whilst there remains and is a commitment to examine this, it is a complex and complicated issue. There are issues of observance. There are issues of information. There are issues of unexpected outbreaks. I mean, I note that there have been cases in recent weeks in Mull. And I also note that there are cases presently in Dendecula, for example, which is in a level one area. So I would like to see those changes, but I don't think that at the present moment it has been possible to completely embrace them and encompass them because of their complications. There are issues, for example, of travel, which we've seen are issues that are contentious even between local authority areas. I think presently the best opportunity for those areas is for the whole of the local authority area to come down in the levels. But I would still be keen to see some progress on this as we move forward, and I remain committed to it. Perhaps Jason Leach would like to say a word or two about it, because there are issues of commonality of use of, for example, medical services, which also impinge upon this. It's not simply a decision about geography.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary and Convener, and thank you for having me back. Good morning, everybody. The two things I would underline, I think Mr. Russell's covered them both, actually. One is the communal nature of our healthcare services. So if you are in Arran, you use Cross House Hospital and the Queen Elizabeth Hospital as your principal escalation hospitals. If they are busy because of Glasgow City cases, I'm afraid that's the consequence of needing intensive care units. Now, much of that can be done in Ayrshire and Arran, but as you escalate, you escalate. If you're a child, then your hospital from Arran would be one of the Ayrshire hospitals and then the Royal Hospital for Children in Glasgow. And quite rightly, that's where the expertise is, of course, at that high level. So that's the first thing. The other is, unfortunately, the nature of the infectious agent, how quickly this virus takes hold. So since we last met, there has been a significant outbreak on Arran. And we could have, for example, not put Arran, because it had almost no cases, into the same restrictions as the rest of Ayrshire in these restrictions we're talking about just now a week or so ago. That would probably not have made any difference to that outbreak, but it just illustrates that you just need one case and it can become 13 cases and 40 cases before you turn your head. It's so quick. And that's why we're cautious, but not completely ruling out the nature of those geographies. It's been quite a big step to go from national to local authorities. And the number of conversations we're now having with local authority leaders, with officials and elected members in those local authorities is time consuming, but justified and the right thing to do. To go one level down again, I think would add a complexity that we're not ready for.
Thank you for that. My second and final question is about the efficacy of measures that have been in place for some time. And it is probably more a question for Professor Leach than the Cabinet Secretary. But many of the areas, for instance, that were moved into level 4 yesterday and were in level 3 last week, have seen a ban on household mixing since the 1st of September. That's over 2.5 months ago. And hospitality restrictions have been in place in different sort of forms for around about a month. Do you think these measures have been effective in light of the sustained high number of cases? And I'd also welcome your views on public compliance and whether that has changed over the last few months.
It is the actual million-dollar question, Mr. Cameron, and it's the question the world wants an answer to. It's the most common question I'm asked. The second most common is, why can I do this and not this? But the most common question is, where is the transmission happening? So you can never know for absolutely sure where the transmission is happening. You can get themes from Test and Protect. The genomics helps you a little bit. But we know from fundamental science, basic science of this virus, that transmission happens when people come together. Where a positive case meets a non-positive case. That's all the virus wants to do. It wants to jump from somebody it's already hosted in to a new person who it isn't hosted in. So every time people meet at work, at play, at school, at wherever, that is possible. So trying to reduce them as much as you can is the way you do it. That's why the lockdown on the 23rd of March in our country, multiple versions of it around the world, that's why it worked. But if you look at the data, it took 8 weeks to get to very, very low numbers because the virus takes a long time to come out of the system and get down. On the 9th of October, I and my senior clinical colleagues published an evidence paper that said the doubling time of the virus was 9 days. The doubling time of the positive cases was 9 days. And at that time, we had around 1,000 cases a day. So that would have meant on the 18th of October, we would have had 2,000 cases. And whatever it is 9 days later, the 27th of October, we would have had 4,000 cases. That didn't happen. So the population of Scotland stopped that happening. What it would appear has happened since, and you can't know this when you're putting the restrictions in, you simply cannot know. What appears to have happened is the system we created for the population and the compliance in the population has got us to 1,200 cases a day. That's roughly what it's got us to. And 40 to 60 deaths on average. and that appears to be stubbornly stable. It doesn't appear to have turned the corner, hence the advice and the decisions in the last 24 hours. And that is really, really hard. The science simply cannot know X will lead to Y. It's not as simple as that. But people should be hopeful, because what they have done so far has worked. It just hasn't worked quick enough to get the misery of this virus over with, because too many people are dying, because too many people are getting infected.
Thank you very much. Not sure if the Cabinet Secretary wants to add to that, but if not, I'll move on to the Deputy Convener, Monica Lennon, for her questions.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, everyone. Maybe if I just stick with the issue around travel and household mixing, because clearly we're going to have regulations coming into effect this week with the travel ban. Can the Cabinet Secretary and Professor Leach say what data they have across the country around compliance? Are there areas, perhaps because of geography and because they are tourist destinations, where we're seeing more people travelling to? And, you know, people have been saying to me in the last couple of days, what's going wrong in Lanarkshire? You know, why are you now getting to level four? And there's a sort of perception here that lots of people are breaking the rules and going to each other's houses. So can we get some of the facts around that, both in terms of the extent to which people are travelling out with their local authority and the extent to which they're mixing in other households?
Jason actually addresses, first of all, the science behind the travel regulations and where he thinks that is, and I'm happy to come in behind him.
We simply cannot know for sure, Ms. Lennon. We cannot know for sure. We're not in everybody's house. I think the vast majority of the country in Lanarkshire and everywhere else are following the rules. I think they're doing a good job. I think on the edge there are people who aren't following the rules in every local authority. And interaction and transmission is happening. It must be happening to get 1,200 cases a day. It is not happening alone. So it's happening in places where people mix, and that includes people's houses. Travel is principally to stop high risk to low risk, whether it's a Greek island, Elgin or Somalia. What you're trying to do is reduce the transmission from high risk to low risk and stop low risk people moving to a high risk area. The opportunities for the virus to spread will simply increase. That's the reason why the advice is to have travel restrictions.
I'm happy to furnish the committee with detail of the travel information that we have. We do have information on the prevalence, for example, of usage of cars, of public transport, which would indicate that from a low level after in the first complete lockdown, then that has been rising. But clearly, putting the travel restrictions in place is designed to make sure that travel is reduced. So we would want to see how far that is reduced, first of all, by the level three restrictions and then by the level four restrictions. So if Monica Lennon will let me, I'll make sure you get some information on the travel detail that we have, which is reasonably comprehensive. And also, I think it's an issue that the committee would want to return to after they see the effect of the travel restrictions. Finish saying there's a lot of anecdotal evidence, and I think Monica Lennon is referring to that, from people who say, you know, so-and-so is travelling from here to there. I mean, I've heard stuff recently in my own area about people travelling so that they could go to different areas to have a meal or something like that. It is very important that we discourage that. The First Minister addressed the issue of enforcement, which I think was raised by Donald Cameron yesterday during the statement. And of course, the enforcement should be as it has been up until now with the police, sensitively done, observing the 4Es, but in the end, making sure that travel does not disrupt what we hope will be successful attempts to reduce the prevalence of the virus.
Thank you. That's very helpful, and I'm sure the committee appreciates the offer of further information. Professor Leach said that transmission happens where people come together. Can I raise it, the issue of schools? Because I became aware from a media report last night that, and this is just one example, but it's a lot of pupils. A school in Glenrothes, is so in Fife, 400 pupils are self-isolating after a COVID outbreak in a high school. That's half the students in the school, 16 positive cases, some pupils, some staff. So the head teacher said that half of the pupils are currently attending school. So schools, particularly big schools, you've got potentially hundreds of households mixing and coming into to contact. And the Parliament will have a debate, of course, on schools this afternoon. But, you know, every day and every week when government are studying patterns of behaviour, looking at the genomics and all the evidence that you have, you know, what is the latest picture on schools, especially when we're seeing, you know, outbreaks of this extent and this level of disruption to young people's education when 400 of them in the one school have to stay at home?
Well, I'll let Jason Leach talk in more detail about the actual situation on the ground. But I think, you know, we have very clearly tried to maintain as much as possible the normality of schooling, and that remains a key objective. Quite clearly, there are very strong reasons for doing so, not least because we are aware of the criticism that existed in terms of disrupting young people's education and a range of issues to do with mental health and well-being, which were really important, learning being, you know, at the top of the list, but there are other issues there too. So maintaining education is extremely important. Now, we must do so safely, and we must do so in a way that is also carefully monitored, but we do intend to do that and to make sure that there is, to the greatest degree possible, a normality in schooling restored and then sustained. But with your permission, Convener, Jason would like to say what the situation is on the ground and also the issue about young people and the way in which there's a slight difference in terms of the prevalence amongst them and the outcomes.
Partly as a result of that question from Ms. Lennon and that repeated question from me and many others about transmission possibilities in schools, Public Health Scotland has done a study of 5 to 17-year-olds. Now, you can't, again, I'm so sorry, you can't tell where people caught the virus. It is simply not possible. So, but if you have infection in 5 to 17-year-olds, that's the risk group. And they're going to publish that later today. So I'm not going to tell you the numbers that are in there, but the numbers of that age group who have positive tests is proportionately small compared to the rest of the population. And that's what we see around the world. This virus is harder to catch if you're young, harder to spread if you're young, and you don't get as sick if you're young. We know that for sure. Particularly if you're very young, primary school gets a little bit more difficult if you're 16, 17, if your body is a bit more adult-like and you cough and splutter as an adult, if you'll forgive the shorthand. The teacher infections and the staff infections follow roughly the community transmission, so you would expect that if it's a call centre, a school, a university, wherever else. So, of course, there will be adults who potentially spread the virus to other adults, and we have to be very careful about that. And that's why we have in place as strong mitigations as we can in schools. But the advisers and the decision makers are combined in their efforts to keep schools and early years open as much as we possibly can, because school is a public health intervention. It is good for children from a public health perspective and a learning perspective for them to be in school. And we didn't like having to advise them to be closed in the first few months of this. Now, that data will be kept up to date. We will, of course, follow it. And I would expect, as transmission rises, cases to rise in schools. That's inevitable. They will rise everywhere. But the best way to get school transmission down is to get population transmission down. So as the number falls, when level 4 now does that for us, which is what we hope, then school prevalence will fall along with community prevalence.
Thanks, Professor Leach. I appreciate you're saying that you can't tell exactly where people catch the virus, but it means that we can't fully rule out schools, so there is a lot of public concern. Just finally then, I think I've heard from both of you today that compliance is high, that the public do deserve praise for the sacrifices that they're all making, but still we've got over 2 million Scots with level 4 protections or restrictions, whatever way you want to look at that. Can I ask what more needs to be done to get us out of this situation without completely wrecking the economy and without further harming people's mental health? At this time of year, we've got kind of dull, dark days. People are struggling. So what else is it? Do you want to do more on Test and Protect? Do you feel that we're not doing enough on Test and Protect?
Well, can I start with what would appear to be a truism, but I think it's really important. You know, what is damaging the economy? What is damaging people's mental health? And I absolutely accept Monica Lennon's point that the dark days, the wild days of November and December are really tough times. And it would be a foolish person who said that they themselves were not affected by this. Everybody is. But the thing that's doing that is the virus. It is the virus which we have to tackle. It is not the government, it is not regulations, it is the virus that is the cause of this. Therefore, what we have to do, all of us have to, collectively, is take the necessary actions to suppress the virus and hopefully in time to eliminate it. And it's not an exact science. I think the First Minister has been very clear about that. But it is a process that is informed by and driven by the work of the clinicians and the scientists, but also judgment comes to bear at the final stage of making decisions. So it is a virus we have to defeat. It is the focus of our attention, and therefore that is what we are endeavouring to do. And we're using the tools at our disposal with sensitivity, on every possible occasion. And I think I've been at this committee 14 or 15 times on every possible occasion, recognizing the exceptional nature of what we're trying to do, being as accountable as we possibly can be for that, and always questioning the actions that are being taken collectively and discussing them in this way as widely as possible. But that is the task that we're engaged in, and that is the task that we must take through in the short term to have a relaxation at Christmas, in the longer term to get us to the stage where the vaccination program is what will make the difference. But Jason would perhaps want to give a more scientific detail than I have.
Actually, no. There's not a lot of science behind my answer. But the WHO and developed world countries, of whom I talk to many, the worst thing for the economy of the nation and the mental health of the nation is not to control the virus. That's the doomsday scenario. So if you allow the virus to get out of control, you damage the economy more and you damage the mental health of the population more. So what you have to do, and this is the whole dilemma that the decision makers in France and Scotland and everywhere else face, is you have to reduce the harm from COVID, the direct harm, while mitigating the other harms. So you have to get the prevalence down. And Scotland now has the lowest prevalence of the 4 UK countries. The Scottish people have done well, but it is not a competition. It's a communal global effort to reduce the harm from this global pandemic. And at the same time, mitigate against the economic harms, the societal harms, the mental health, the loneliness, the schools, all of those other elements at the same time. That's what makes this unprecedented. Nobody has ever had to do this before. So that's why it's so difficult. And that's why questioning like this is absolutely appropriate to get us to the right answers.
Thank you. Can I call William Rennie, please?
Just a first quick question. For people living in level 3 and 4, as of Friday, will international travel be illegal?
International travel won't be illegal because it would require the UK to do that. But travelling to the airport or to a port for that purpose would be against the regulations.
So even if it's if people who live in Glasgow, can they go to Glasgow Airport to go on a non-essential international trip?
No, I don't believe they can. No.
Right. Okay, that's helpful. The second question then is about behaviour. Supervisors are keen to understand what the thinking is behind this. It's clear that the First Minister indicated yesterday that many people are not adhering to the ban on indoor visiting. And there is a line of thinking that a supervised, regulated, organised environment like pubs, cafes, restaurants is a safer place than the unregulated home. And I'm just wondering, since we've not managed to get the virus down to the levels that we wanted with the current restrictions, is there any added weight to that argument now? This is probably more of a question for Professor Leach.
Yeah, I think it is.
It's a good question, Mr. Rennie. I can tell you that no country in the world has chosen to keep its hospitality open when their prevalence rises. The WHO and pretty much every government in the world with cafes and restaurants, I mean, France, with a cafe culture, a famous cafe culture, has shut its hospitality and gone further than many other countries in curfews. Italy, you can't leave your home in certain regions of Italy without written evidence of why you're leaving your home. So yes, I think people are still meeting in households. I think some of them are doing that safely, but the rule is not to do it. And it's very, very restrictive. But I can't think of a way of making that more regulated or more enforced that wouldn't take away huge civil liberties that none of us want to do. So in order to get the transmission down, we're therefore left with everywhere else people can meet. I don't think having the restaurants and cafes open means people won't meet in their houses, unfortunately. And I think our evidence now suggests that's the case, because level three has managed to get the numbers stable, but it hasn't in the main been quick enough to get the numbers down to stop the deaths.
So you don't support the argument that it's a pressure cooker, and that people are desperate to have social engagement, desperate to meet others, and they'll find a way of doing that. So there's no weight to the argument that we should release that pressure cooker by, you know, those who are trained and organised to supervise their environments, to control that release. I mean, if we've been able to do it on construction sites and manufacturing sites, is there not an argument to say that pubs and restaurants are capable of doing it as well?
It's compelling. Your argument is compelling, but construction and manufacturing are tiny numbers compared to 5 million people being released to go to hospitality. And that's kind of what we did. I came to this committee and said the reason we've kept cafes open is for social isolation. I mean, single parents, elderly people who use cafes basically as community centres to meet their pals. I want all of that. It's a hugely compelling argument that in that safe environment, older people, single parents, those who have no connection, no work, so they don't meet people during the day, but it hasn't worked quick enough, which is why very, very reluctantly this weekend, our advice was to go to level four in some areas, because we know that the 23rd of March worked. It worked in the sense that the prevalence fell. Now, there are harms from that. Of course there are harms, and we've touched on some of them around the economy and the business and the social isolation and the loneliness. And I'm not dismissing them or not immune to them. But the reality is we have too many infections and we have to get them down.
Okay, my final set of questions are for the Minister. So two examples of businesses that are not receiving support when in principle they should. So there's businesses that are required to close, like nightclubs. They're not receiving the business closure support grant, and I'm just wondering why that is. And the second example is businesses that are restricted by restricted in their activities by the new arrangements, and they're not getting access to the hardship fund like holiday accommodation, B&Bs, etc. Why is the grant system not comprehensive enough to cover the areas that in principle should be getting support?
Well, it is comprehensive and it is wide-ranging, but of course there will always be in any system anomalies that develop. You're a, Mr. Rennie, a constituency MSP as I am, you will know from your mailbag that will occur, and as constituency MSPs, I'm sure you and I will take those issues up both at local level with local authorities that are distributing money and at national level with Kate Forbes and with Fiona Hislop. And the system does change and does develop. The announcements that the First Minister made will come into yesterday about level four areas will come into effect as quickly as possible, and that will widen the net. I suspect you have too. I have two or three individuals who I believe should have had support and have not had support in my constituency. And it will require continued persistence and work to try and develop and change the system to make that happen. And that's one of the reasons, you know, we're there and trying to do it. And I think all of us as MSPs should be making representations, both on the individual and the generic, where we see things aren't working and trying to get the system changed. I want to pay tribute to the local authorities who've done a remarkable job. I mean, you know, I'm not well known as a close friend of a local authority in my area. I have been unstinting in my praise for them and the work that they have done and continue to be so. But it is incredibly difficult, and we must keep trying to work to make sure as many people as possible are covered.
I have heard from Aileen Morton that you have been full of praise for the council, so I'm sure they appreciate that, and perhaps you and I can join forces to persuade Kate Forbes to change the grant scheme. But that's me finished, convener.
Nothing is impossible, Mr. Rennie. Nothing is impossible.
Thank you. Thank you for that. Can I turn next, please, to Willie Coffey?
Thanks very much, convener, and good morning, everyone. I wonder, Minister, Professor Leach, could I turn the conversation to Ayrshire? Please, as you might imagine, a number of constituents have been in touch asking me for explanations as to why East Ayrshire has been moved up to level four. If you look at some of the data and the tables that was issued along with the First Minister's statement yesterday, you'll actually see that East Ayrshire's test positivity rates have been dropping steadily since the middle of October. So one of the questions I'm being asked is, why are we going to level four if that's the case? One of the other tables in the data that was issued also yesterday predicts the probability of infection over the next 2 weeks in both East Ayrshire and North Ayrshire, but the probability figures are lower for East Ayrshire than they are for North Ayrshire. So I'm being asked these sorts of questions to try to offer explanations why East Ayrshire has been moved up to level four, and I'd be really obliged if you could help to explain why this is the case.
I think that's for Jason Leach.
So I have the 32 local authority data charts here because I figured this might be one of the essential questions. We've also published these. They're a little bit tricky to find for people. I think it's important that we point them towards them as much as we can. They don't give the whole picture, though. So before I describe East Ayrshire's data in more detail, it's not a formula. You don't take this number, and this number and get a four. It just isn't as easy as that, because we have to ask in local authorities, we have to ask the directors of public health, we have to think about where people go to hospital from there. We have to think about the geography. We also have to think about the stability or otherwise of that data. Are they moving upwards or downwards, or are they stubbornly stable? So it's not just the data. But to take the principal data point, which is prevalence, and we describe that as a 7-day average per 100,000. So that allows us to compare Liverpool with Nigeria with East Ayrshire. So that's the same number around the whole world. So you can take the number of positive cases over a seven-day period and divide it by 100,000. So that allows you to make a comparison. The Scottish average is 140, roughly, just now. We want it to be below 50 across the whole country. About half of the country, inevitably, are above the Scottish average, are above 140. And in the main, they are the group that we've moved to level four, because they are the ones that are too high. And unfortunately, East Ayrshire falls into that group. So in the last 5 days on this data, East Ayrshire has been 179, 180, 184, 179, 165. Stubbornly stable. Now, the 165 may be the beginning of a fall, but unfortunately, no reliable data over time to suggest that. And East Ayrshire actually illustrates the challenge. If you look at the graphs that we published, it is absolutely straight. And it's straight in cases per 100,000 and test positivity unfortunately, in the last few days. And the people of East Ayrshire have done a good job. They've done well. But the closeness to the rest of the Central Belt and that stubborn data is why we advised East Ayrshire to go up a level. And nobody, including me, wanted to do that.
Thanks very much for that, Professor Leach. Could I just take you up on that analysis there? I'm looking at the East Ayrshire test positivity chart. I suppose it depends where you pick your starting point from to say whether it's flat or whether it's going down or up. So I've chosen the middle of October to just now. The overall trend is downwards for East Ayrshire, and you've chosen the last few days and said that it's flat. I mean, how do you pick which one in order to make the decision to be three or four?
Yeah, it's a good question, and you're right. Since let's call it the second peak, East Ayrshire has fallen. So mine starts here on the one we published, starts on the 5th of November with a positivity rate of 7. Remember, what we want for positivity is less than 5. So the two WHO targets are 50 per 100,000 and 5% positivity. Now, Scotland's overall positivity is about 7, too high. So and East Ayrshire has been 7, 7.2, 7.4, 7.7. Now, it was higher. I absolutely accept that. Now it is stuck at 7, along with much of the rest of the country. And that's why we think less interaction will bring that down, which is why 4, unfortunately, has been the decision.
Mm-hmm. And just on that point that I made about the probability prediction over the next few weeks, it is actually a lower probability in East Ayrshire than it is in North Ayrshire. How do you answer that point?
So again, that's about comparison of single data points. So North Ayrshire has slightly better data across the board and different geography, different advice from others in there, directors of public health and local on the ground, outbreaks, etc. So in the round, the decision was that North Ayrshire just scraped out of level four, but just, and will have a very, very close watch kept on it. And the nature of movement was people were very concerned. You know that area better than me. The Cabinet Secretary for Health knows that area very well and was concerned about travel and movement around the Ayrshires. But the decision on balance was in the round that North Ayrshire should not move to a four.
Okay, thank you for that. My last question, convener, maybe one more for the Cabinet Secretary. It's about the test and protect process. We see big stores, retail stores, supermarkets and so on, they don't take contact details. Perhaps it's too impractical for them to do that. Some of them are already announcing that they're extending their opening hours. They don't really manage the movement of the public when they get into these stores in any meaningful way. I was in one last week that was absolutely chock-a-block with customers. So surely that is a prime candidate for one of the major problems that we face here. So what can we do to try and enforce proper management of numbers being allowed into these stores and proper management of people when they get in there? And is there any work being done to try to develop some kind of app that can announce your arrival at these stores so that you're part of the system and to be part of track and trace? Because they're not at the moment in these bigger retail stores and supermarkets.
I think you make a good point that we need constant vigilance in terms of how social distancing is observed. Now, clearly, now we have a requirement, a legal requirement, people should wear face coverings in shops, and that needs to be observed. But we have recently, and I think the Deputy First Minister referred to this the other day, we have recently intervened again to remind the supermarket chains and others of the absolute importance of managing crowds and groups of people and people shopping, particularly in two sets of circumstances. Now, in level four areas where there will be there will be a limited number of places that people can go quite clearly, and secondly in the run up to Christmas. So you are making a really important point. I think it is impractical to expect there to be a technological solution to this, but there is a very simple solution, which is a solution that was applying from March onwards, that there was a rigorous observance of these matters. And we know more now. I mean, we've learned a great deal. And therefore, those running these stores at every level. I mean, I suspect as a local member, you've had the experience I've had when we've spoken to chains. They've said, oh, well, this is for the local manager. And the local manager says, no, this is something for that's not being enforced at HQ. The reality is it has to be enforced. It should happen. You've drawn attention to it. I'm glad to have the chance to have responded to it. I hope the large chains and the smaller chains and the smaller ones are looking at this and saying, look, we've got to get this properly. And there's been some very imaginative stuff too. I can think of small shops I know that have been very imaginative and rigorous and done it well. That's what we should all be doing.
Okay, thanks very much, Mike. Thank you, Jason. Back to you, convener.
Thank you, Willie. Can I turn next to Mark Ruskell?
Yeah, thanks, convener, and good morning to you both. I'd like to just briefly return to a question which I asked you at the last meeting, and that was about the effectively black spots that we have in Scotland with a lack of testing centres on the ground. I raised the issue of Perth at the last meeting, and very pleased that within a couple of days after that, a testing centre was set up in Perth. But can I ask you, how confident are you that we actually have the right testing centres on the ground in Scotland to meet the current objectives around testing?
Well, I'll allow Jason to do that as he's closer in terms of day-to-day testing. But the Health Secretary has been very, very clear that the programme that is in place to expand testing in a variety of different ways is moving forward, and is moving forward with a full weight, her weight and the weight of government behind it, and that's how it will continue to be done. Nobody is complacent about that. Nobody is avoiding doing that. That is what we wish to do within the lines of human possibility, and that is what we're trying to do. But, for example, I was involved in a discussion last week about the issue of walk-in testing within my own constituency and where the best centre would be in an area of challenging geography. So there are whole ranges of things taking place and being done as quickly as is possible. But Jason might want to say a word or two about both what is happening on the ground and also how testing is changing and developing, because we had indications of that from the First Minister yesterday in her statement, and the way in which things are progressing in terms of technology.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, and Mr. Ruskell. I'm glad that the challenge of Perth that you raised the last time is at least partly resolved. I'm as confident as I can be, which is relatively confident about what we've seen around testing around the country. It does give me the opportunity to thank hundreds of people who now do this for a living, people who were working in our laboratories or working in our health and social care system, and a huge number of new employees who have come in and helped us with testing, as well as the military and the logistics people who are doing this, both at a UK government level and at a Scottish level. It's been an enormous human endeavour to get these set up. We now have fixed sites. We have mobile sites, which we can move around the country depending on where the numbers are and where the outbreaks are. And we have these walk-in centres, principally around hotspots of students, but not only. And they're all going very well. The testing logistics is also going well. The laboratories, there are days where there are blips, of course, because it's a massive human endeavour. Unfortunately, it comes at the same time as we're trying to vaccinate the population for flu. We're trying to get ready for a COVID vaccine, and the testing technology is changing. So it's absolutely massive. Compared to other European countries, we are testing high numbers of the population, and we continue to have testing available for all symptomatic people. There isn't a problem in getting an appointment, and we're increasing the number of asymptomatic tests that we're doing around the country for different, let's call them hotspots, care homes, whatever group we might want to do next. And the technology, although not entirely reliable as the PCR test, is coming, is getting better. I was on another call last night with all of the UK, the four UK countries, Tuesday night senior clinicians call, about 20 of us that we've been meeting since this pandemic began every Tuesday and Thursday evening, to think about what we do with that next level of testing, with that next set of technology, which again will be a big logistical challenge. Some of it will be in people's homes, some of it will be in testing sites. So I'm confident that it's going as well as it can.
Okay, thanks. Can I now turn to the experience in schools? Cabinet Secretary, you said earlier on that the normality of schooling is absolutely critical for children. But can I ask you about the experience in our schools, particularly in level four areas? I'm aware that in Stirling, for example, there's one school where we have six classes that are self-isolating at the moment. The entire class is self-isolating. Classroom teachers are off. SLA support staff for children with additional needs are off. Supply teachers are being brought in, teachers who don't necessarily know the classes. And teachers are working extremely hard. But what about that normality of that experience? Is there not a case that within level four areas, that there should be a shift to some form of blended learning for those schools?
I hope the phrase I used, and certainly I'll use it now if I didn't then, is as close to normal as possible. Of course, we're in the midst of a pandemic. You know, we're in the midst of a second stage of a pandemic in which numbers have been rising very fast. There will, of course, be pressures in individual schools. Professor Leach indicated that in his earlier answer, and nobody would deny that. And I think the Deputy First Minister has indicated too that there may well be circumstances in which in some places there have to be changes, no matter if they are short-lived, simply to cope with these struggles. But I go back to the main point I make. I think there was a unanimity across the Parliament that we should endeavour to get education back to as normal as possible, as soon as possible, and to maintain it there, difficult as it may be in certain circumstances. And I pay enormous tribute to parents, to teachers, to the school community. I'm a former education secretary. I think that Scottish education is strong, and I think Scottish education performs well, but people are being asked to go well beyond what any of us would have expected, even 6 months, 9 months, a year ago. So in those circumstances, to keep as close to normal as possible, to recognise when the problems occur that they need urgent action and to attend to them, is the right thing to do, and that is what is being done. And I think, given the ability, the strength, the commitment of teachers and school communities, then we should be thanking them for that and doing our best to support them. Jason might want to say something about on the ground again, but essentially, trying to get and maintain as normal as possible an education is, I think, something that is supported right across the Parliament.
Rather than repeat the data I gave earlier, which will be coming out later today from Public Health Scotland, I may use narrative on this occasion, Mr. Ruskell. I live with a North Lanarkshire teacher, and you can be absolutely certain that I hear of North Lanarkshire and other teaching and education stories. My wife now teaches English as an additional language. She's been an English teacher and a pupil support teacher for decades, but now she teaches English as an additional language. And she teaches a young Syrian girl who was in primary school, and she was blown up in an explosion with her sister in Syria, and Scotland took her in and has now taught both of these children for the last couple of years, and my wife teaches her English. The thought of removing that young girl's education in any meaningful way, not just the English teaching, which is a kind of byproduct of what the school provides for this young lady. And I've seen images of this little girl beaming when she has pals around her, when she has support, when she has everything that schools provide around community care. The thought of removing that again is horrible. Now, I know that sometimes that will have to be done, and you illustrate it with classes having to self-isolate and teachers having to self-isolate or even be positive and therefore losing some of that continuity. But my advice is consistently to try and keep the schools open as much as we can, not just for that young Syrian young lady, but for all of the population of Scotland.
I'll just ask a final question then on this topic. And, you know, the First Minister announced yesterday that, you know, children who were previously in a shielded category should not go to school. So there's a clear category of children who are being advised not to attend school. However, teachers that were previously in a shielded category are still being advised to attend and to be in that school environment. Is that fair? Is that a good practice to ask teachers to continue to come in?
For me? So that's not quite what we've said, Mr. Ruskell, to be fair. What we've said is that children who were in the previously shielded group, now that's a very small number because we adjusted the shielded group for children as we've learned more about the virus. So there are a small number of children in level four areas where we think the risk is high enough that we should keep those children out of school for the period of the level four restrictions. And I think that's a risk-adjusted, a risk-based judgment that we think is appropriate. What we have said about level four areas and all employees, including teachers, is that work from home if you can. If you can't work from home, you should have a conversation with your employer. That might be your head teacher, it may be your local authority, it might be your call centre boss, it might be the head of the Scottish Parliament. And if mitigations can be put in place, they should be. So if a teacher who is very high risk, and remember, shielding is not binary, it's not no risk, high risk. There are people in that group who are very high risk. Could it be that you could have a back office job for 3 weeks? Could it be that you could do some work from home on behalf of all the rest of the teachers in your institution or whatever? So we're not forcing anybody to go to work and put themselves at risk. What we're suggesting is that there be an individual conversation with the high risk group inside their workplace, whether that workplace is the civil service, the Scottish Parliament, or a high school. Now, it's more difficult to work from home if you're a teacher. Again, my wife is one. So I completely understand that might be a little bit tricky, but that's where we think the decision should be made at that local level. You can now do on, I think it's MyGovScot, or maybe it's just MyGov. You can now do an individual risk assessment that allows you to answer questions about your own risk. That because we've learned so much about the virus, we now know obesity is a much bigger problem than it was. We've always known about age. We now know heart failure and diabetes are a little bit more of a risk than we thought they were before. So there's ways, and the previously shielded group has been adjusted to allow for that.
Okay, thanks.
I've got a couple of supplementaries, and please can we be as quick as possible? First, Willie, and then Monica.
Professor Leach, I think in practice it doesn't seem to be working that way. I've got constituents in Fife who have had just a blanket instruction to return back to work, and their only route out of this is to sign off sick. I'm just wondering whether we can look at this again and if I can provide that information to you and your colleagues to see if this policy can be looked at.
Of course, Mr. Rennie, I'd be very, very happy to do that. We're sending letters out, I think, today or tomorrow. We drafted them yesterday in order to the people who were previously in the shielded group to give them the instructions I've just outlined. We will, of course, share them with local authorities, with head teachers, and it's not going to be an exact science. That's a tough thing for a head teacher who's already got people off, who's trying to juggle kids who are off. I completely understand that, but let's try and make that as smooth as we can and reduce the risk as much as we can.
Monica?
On the issue of children who are in the shielding group who are now being advised, if they're in level four, not to attend school in person, can I ask if that guidance also applies to siblings of those children who live in the same house?
No, it doesn't.
Thank you.
Thank you. That was a helpful clarification. Can I turn next to Annabel Ewing, please?
I'm sorry, Convener.
Thank you, Convener.
I come in to make a point.
Yes.
I'm sorry, whoever is operating the microphones doesn't appear to have recognised it. I just wanted to make a point to Willie Rennie about the issue of those people who may be forced to go to work. There is a legal protection for people in those circumstances. I mean, that's been clear from the very beginning. It is difficult for people to exercise it because they are worried about their employment and their employment prospects. Again, there is a place for representatives to be active in that and to make sure that they are active on behalf of individuals. But people should not be in doubt that there is a requirement for safe workplaces. And that is an absolute right that people have to expect and is protected by law.
Thank you for that. So, Annabel Ewing, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, colleagues, and good morning to the Cabinet Secretary and Professor Beach. A few questions. So, first one, as the MSP for Cowdenbeath constituency, obviously particularly interested in the position of Fife, and that's actually what at least the formal agenda item it requires us to do, to look inter alia at Fife. And in terms of the announcement yesterday with the Liffin local authorities to be in level four till the 11th of December, I assume that that means, therefore, that the weekly review substantively will continue as far as the other 21 local authorities are concerned, and therefore with the possibility of movement up or indeed down. Perhaps I could just get clarification on that point from either the CABSEC or Professor Leach.
Yes, that is the case. The reviews will continue. That was quite clear from the First Minister's statement yesterday, and there is no doubt about that.
Okay, I thank that the CABSEC for that unequivocal clarification. It's just that people had been asking me. Secondly, in regard to Fife, obviously one of the issues which I think resulted in Fife going from level two the previous week to level three was, of course, a slight worrying increase in the number of ICU beds being used. And I wonder perhaps if Professor Leach can confirm that matter, which of course causes some anxiety on the part of my constituents, is being monitored very carefully. Perhaps Professor Leach could clarify the position.
Of course, and yes is the answer. And intensive care works as one system really around the country. Of course you go to your closest, but then we, if we have to, have capacity in neighbouring health boards and around the country. And there's no intensive care on the islands, of course, so we move people off when they need it. So intensive care works as one big system. It has been expanded. We already have more people in it than at conventional times, remember. So if you get to intensive care, you are very, very seriously unwell, and we have already had to move it into bigger numbers, and we are ready to move it again if we have to, which is, of course, why we're having these horrible restrictions. I wish I'd printed these data sheets in slightly bigger type, but the intensive care numbers in the intensive care forecast in Fife has risen in the last week, which is what you would expect. The restrictions put in a week ago won't have had any effect yet, and that's exactly what we'd expect. So it looks worse in Fife this week than it did last week, but that's the nature of the virus and the nature of the restrictions always playing catch-up on the virus. And the prevalence in Fife has risen in the last week, but not to the extent where we thought level four was yet necessary. But Fife is a high three now. You remember I said the Scottish average was about 140 per 100,000. Well, Fife is now just about on that margin, and we want everywhere to be 50.
I thank Professor Leach for that clarification. Obviously, that will be a further worry to my constituents and people across Fife, but perhaps a carrot to reinforce the message of sticking with these rules. And in that regard, a number of queries I'm sure that we all get are, you know, can I do this? Can I see somebody in a care home? Can I go and visit in a hospice? Can I go and visit my mother? I'm dying. Can I, you know, and there is actually helpful, an exhaustive list of exceptions to the what will become actually a travel ban as of Friday in terms of level 3 and 4 areas. My plea would be perhaps to the Cabinet Secretary, is there some way that we can make this information more publicly accessible? I know it's on the website, but you know, the number of queries we get as MSPs as to can I move from A to B, can I go as an extended household? It would be helpful, I think, for people to have a much clearer idea of what the exceptions are, because most people want to abide by the guidance and indeed from Friday abide by the law.
There is a very clear list of exemptions, which will be published as part of the regulations. You know, they will be laid out very clearly indeed. They are essentially the exemptions that have existed. There are one or two additions to that. I am absolutely in favour of having maximum clarity, but in any set of circumstances, there will always be questions that require some thinking about them, and there will always be interpretation of certain issues. But the list of exemptions in travel will be very clear in the regulations, and I would commend it to every MSP. I keep it myself on, you know, on my phone and on the computer, so I'm absolutely clear when people ask me that these are the exemptions that exist.
Okay, thanks. And I appreciate we have a job to do as well as MSPs to help disseminate the information, but I would make that plea because, as I say, people want to abide in the main by what the rules are, and they just want to know what they can do. My last question, convener, if I may. We saw guidance published about Halloween, so I'm moving beyond Christmas here. I've got a longer focus, and I'm asking about Hogmanay. So I wonder if both the Cabinet Secretary and Professor Leach can comment on where matters stand anent Hogmanay. Thank you.
I think Jason has been involved in the Christmas discussions more than I have. I'm sure he will want to say something about it. But, you know, anent Hogmanay, which is a good two Scots words running together into the same sentence, I think there would be a recognition that Hogmanay is a very important issue in Scotland. But, you know, there's also a recognition that the virus is a threat that continues to exist. But Jason may wish to say something about the discussions that are taking place about the Christmas season, I suppose, you should, Christmas and New Year season.
I was asked on the radio this morning if we polled the Scottish population, if they could only have 1 week, which would they choose? And I wasn't quite sure of the answer. In fact, I think we'd probably choose both. There are four country level conversations at two levels, both at clinical and official level, my level at a four country level, and at a political level, a First Minister, Mr. Gove, others discussing Christmas and New Year. We would like to do that at a four country level, but time is marching, and it will be on us soon. All of us would like some kind of household mixing to be possible, and the prevalence rate is the crucial decider in that. We don't want people to have to do it surreptitiously or people to have to break the rules in order to have some kind of safe Christmas, but we do want a safe Christmas and a safe New Year, and they will not be normal. I don't think anybody thinks this will be the same as 2019, or it will be the same as 2021, I hope. So there will be differences, but we're very keen that something different will be allowable, and we'll be very clear about what we think that should be. Other countries, other cities are struggling with this even now. New York put out its Christmas guidance a couple of days ago on a big graphic sheet. I think it was pretty good. It was quite restrictive, though, and we will look at that and examples from other places, and we'll judge against our own prevalence what we think is safe. The last thing we want here is freedom and then January to have increased mortality, increased infections and increased death inside families who met at Christmas. That would be a horrible, horrible scenario to have to face. So reduced prevalence now is number one for Christmas and New Year, and then guidance about what we think a safe Christmas and New Year will look like.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Leach.
Annabel, is that everything?
Yes, thank you, Commissioner.
Thank you for that, and that's very helpful given that we've got a session about Christmas and New Year and the festive period after this, so that's a very helpful background. Can I turn next to Shona Robertson, please?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, everyone. I have a couple of questions, one really leading on from Annabel Ewan's line of questioning about the coming travel restrictions for levels 3 and 4. In the area of Dundee Angus, things are very integrated. As you can imagine, that's not unique to here, but the people share the same leisure and shopping facilities, for example. And I've had a flurry of inquiries from people who would make the point that they may have to travel further within their own local authority to access those facilities than they would in their neighbouring authority. So how, in terms of non-essential journeys, how does that apply to shopping and leisure? Is that going to be laid out very clearly in the guidance that comes? Because I think people have these quite detailed questions about accessing particularly leisure and shopping facilities.
And I think that, you know, we need to be very clear both in the regulations, which, you know, we will be publishing this week, and also in the communications around the legislation. I mean, it is, people are being told they cannot travel outside their local authority area. People are being told to, you know, to take the example that Willie Rennie had raised, you know, people are told that there are international travel restrictions. People are being advised strongly against international travel, and there will be quarantining from a large number of places, as it is now, for anybody involved in travel. But there are always grey areas around the edges. People will, you know, unfortunately, there are some people who will wish to exploit those grey edges, and there are some people who are uncertain about what the regulations are. So what we need to do is to be absolutely clear about what the exemptions are in terms of travel, but also about what the intention is. And I just want to stress that for a moment. It's really important. The intention, you know, as both Jason and I have indicated very, very strongly here, as the First Minister has indicated yesterday, is to tackle a situation in which the prevalence of the virus is not falling fast enough at a time when we are desperately concerned that if it does not fall fast enough, then the winter pressures and the inevitable pressures as we come into the new year will create a situation in which, to be blunt, the National Health Service may be, you know, put under enormous pressure that is difficult to deal with and will result in a loss of lives. So we have to get this sorted. And to get this sorted, you know, in a way which we've not yet succeeded, although, as Jason has indicated from the beginning, as we all know, we have had some success with that. To get it sorted, it is required to have substantially stronger regulations. Not exactly the same as we had in the lockdown in March, but substantially stronger regulations, which will take effect this Friday. So people should understand the intention. And I hope want to be part. The vast majority of people do want to be part, making sure that that intention is fulfilled for the limited period of time which the First Minister has committed herself to. So that's really important. I always take the lesson from this committee that we need to be clearer and we need to be as clear as possible. And that's a lesson I take again here today. And we'll make sure when we publish the regulations, particularly in travel, we will do everything we can to clarify that. But the intention is a really important thing. If you're in doubt, don't do it. If you're in doubt, recognise the intention and ask, does that square with what I'm wanting to do now? Please, that is important.
Hey, thank you for that. On a kind of related matter about the family bubbles, again, a few questions being raised where people have been in a family bubble across different local authority areas. On Friday, are they still able to travel as to be part of that family bubble, even if they're in a level 3 or 4 area? Or it'd be a level 3 area.
One of the exemptions.
One of the exemptions is for
extended households. That is absolutely clear. Now there are a set of regulations and guidance around extended households. Those are on the web. It is really important that people understand those. But yes, extended households continue to operate.
That's very helpful. And just finally, the question on the figures. Dundee has been fluctuating with, you know, down 29% one week, up 11% the next. Just to ask Jason specifically, presumably it's the trend you're looking for, because there will be these fluctuations. So in order to come down from level three to level two, Dundee presumably would have to be consistently on a pattern or a trend and trajectory across those figures. I know you look at other issues as well, but sticking to the cases per 100,000, is that essentially what you would be looking for in making the judgment?
The curve, statistically. So is it continuing to fall? And the pace of the fall. So if it falls over 6 months, that's not helping us much. We want it to fall over a three-week period, for example. A three, four, two incubation periods gives you about 4 weeks, or 3 to 4 weeks. So that's where we are. And Dundee, I just brought up Dundee because I saw you starting to speak inevitably. And I'm learning where HMSP represents, although I know yours for historical reasons. Dundee is pretty flat in the last few days, and that needs to just tip over and come down. And they are at about the Scottish average. Remember, I said those above the Scottish average in the main have been moved to level four. Those around and below have been maintained at their level, and those quite far down have actually been moved down a level. So we should mention Mid Lothian and East Lothian, who have come down a level. So it is possible for those numbers to fall and be consistently low so that we can move down a level. But Dundee City, having moved up, has stabilised. Now it needs to just turn that corner.
OK, thank you. That's all from me, Convener.
Thank you, Shona. Can I turn next to Maurice Corry, please?
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, can I just follow on from a point that Shona Riverson just talked about shopping? Because I get asked this constantly. Because in Helensburgh, for example, is where I'm talking about, and Jason may want to turn up his information on that, it's level two, as in Argyll and Bute. And over the hill, we've got level four, which is Dumbarton, okay, West Dumbartonshire. And now this question I'm constantly asked is travel for shopping, because we have a big Morrison store, we have a little there, we have an Aldi and everything else in Dumbarton. Are people allowed to travel from a level two to a level four to shop? Essentially,
I would strongly advise against it. I'd want to go back and look at the exemptions, and there would have to be an understanding of what essential shopping was. But Helensburgh has shops. You know, they remain open, and the opportunity exists for people to shop there. So I would very strongly advise against such travel. I would want to look at the exact wording of the essential travel exemptions on this, and I will do that and come back to you and make sure that is clarified for you and for others. But my very strong advice, I don't think, Mr. Corry, I can put it strongly enough, is that is not a good idea. Jason might want to say something.
I think it's back to Mr. Russell's point earlier about what it is we're trying to do here. Unfortunately, we're not allowing shopping for social reasons. So my father loves nothing more than a trip to the supermarket, and it's not to buy shopping. It's to chat to pals that he meets in the shop. That is not what we're allowing at whatever level you're in, because that's human interaction that we need to remove in order to reduce the prevalence. So if you can get your essential shopping in some other way, we'd like you not to do that. So actually what we'd like you to do is get deliveries. We'd like other people to bring your shopping. So my father is no longer doing his shopping. My sister is doing his shopping and delivering it to his back door. So it's a mindset, though, and it's really, really difficult. So we want people to, of course, get their essential shopping. If they can do that with delivery, they should. If they can do that locally, they should. And only if they absolutely have to. And I understand, particularly Ms. Robinson's example between Dundee City and Angus, where it might be the same street. So if your local corner store is in a different local authority and it's 50 feet from your door and you need to go there for milk and bread, then I don't think anybody's going to stop you doing that. But driving into Dundee City to go to the Morrisons, I would try and avoid that if I possibly could.
Okay, that's fine. That's quite clear. I think that would be useful, Cabinet Secretary, to have that definition. If you were going to pass it on, that'd be great. Thank you. Can I ask another question? It's to do with driving tests. And as obviously you see in the regulation now, level four, the driving tests are out for the next 3 or 4 weeks. So the question here is, and I'm being asked, is people who've taken their theory test are now faced with a dilemma because some theory tests will expire within the time of the lockdown of the 4 weeks or 3 weeks in level four areas. So can I ask if the Cabinet Secretary would consider an extension to the theory test, rather like the MOTs have been extended for vehicles by 6 months? Because I think that would be a fair opportunity to look at that. Because I know a few people have come to me and said, hang on, that's my theory test going to expire. I can't face another one. And as it is, we've got to get drivers through. And we know there's a backlog of tests, driving tests. And obviously that means people can't get jobs because some of their jobs are related to driving, et cetera, et cetera. So can the Cabinet Secretary look at that?
That is a reserved matter. I would be greatly sympathetic towards it. It seems to me entirely sensible, but it is a reserved matter. So it would be a matter for the.
Yeah, but could Cabinet Secretary not? Can you, in your discussions with the other governments and obviously the UK government, bring that matter up, please?
I will ask the Transport Secretary to raise it. I've raised the issue of driving tests myself on behalf of a constituent who had difficulty with this and needed a driving test in order to get a job. But I just make the point, and it's an important point to make, not everything within this is in the gift of the Scottish Government. That is a matter which needs to be raised with the UK government, and I will ask the Transport Secretary to raise it. I'm sure others will wish to raise it too.
Thank you very much. And the final point, Convener, again, Cabinet Secretary and obviously Jason, the question is, what is the definition exactly of an extended household?
It is on the website, Mr. Curry. It's very clear about how you form an extended household and what an extended household is. I would commend to you that information, but I don't want to, I could go online now and read it out, but I think it'd be best that you look at it and read it. It's very clear what it is.
Right. Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Jason, I think, wanted to say a word or two about that.
Yes, Jason.
I'm sorry. Yeah.
So not to read it out. Mr. Russell's correct. Strictly speaking, you should read it out. In simple terms, it is you can combine your household with somebody who lives alone or somebody who lives alone with children. And therefore, that then becomes one household, both in terms of test and protect, remember, but also in terms of no distancing, and you can gather together. If one of the two parties lives alone or lives alone with children.
That's very clear. Thank you very much. That's what I was looking for. Thank you.
Finally, could we have Stuart McMillan, please?
Thank you, Convener. Just a couple of questions. The first one is towards the Cabinet Secretary. But before I ask the question, I do want to say thank you regarding Inverclyde's position to stay in Tier 3 as compared to the potential with Tier 4 with other neighbouring authorities. But with 11 local authorities moving to Level 4, what considerations have been given to student teachers who may be on a placement and travelling between areas of differing levels of restrictions, particularly for those who may rely upon public transport or who also live in student accommodation?
It's a very good point. There is an exemption for work and for essential work. I think what I would want to do would be to get that clarified as quickly as possible, and I'll undertake to ask John Swinney to do that to you and to the committee very quickly indeed.
No, thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. My second question is an area that's been touched upon earlier on by Willie Coffey, which is to do with supermarkets. I was contacted by a constituent who actually works for a large supermarket in my constituency last week, who was raising concerns about the lack of health and safety measures put in place by that particular store. So they were concerned about their own health, but also the health of the patrons to that particular commercial market. So in terms of the dialogue and discussions that have taken place between the Scottish Government and the retailers, particularly the large retailers, I think you mentioned the other Cabinet Secretary that that dialogue continues, but particularly as we're about to go into, I think, what clearly is the most important part and most important time for any retailer. Can that message be strengthened, please, just to highlight to them how important it is that they do the right thing by their staff, but also by the customers?
It can be strengthened. It can also be amplified. Local members have a role here when they have their attention to escalate that, both in terms of government and in terms of the stores and the store management locally and nationally. So, you know, it is not a matter of a single voice. It's a matter of as many voices as possible. But I also go back to the point I made in terms of a legal duty for a safe working environment. That is a legal duty that employers have. And, you know, trade unions have a strong role to play in this matter too. And I know they are very active in making sure that those points are put across.
No, thank you. I certainly have taken it up with that particular supermarket. But I thought we'd take the opportunity this morning, also bearing in mind it's a parliamentary committee, to raise it also, to raise it publicly also. Convener, I'm content with my questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Stuart, and thank you to all members and our witnesses for that session. Can I now move to the second agenda item, which is consideration of the motions on the subordinate legislation that the committee took evidence on at its meeting on the 4th of November. The SSIs give effect to the Scottish Government's new strategic framework for COVID-19, which came into effect on the 2nd of November. The SSIs are as follows. The Health Protection Coronavirus Restrictions and Requirements Local Alert Levels Scotland Regulations 2020 SSI 2020-344 and the Health Protection Coronavirus Restrictions and Requirements Local Levels Scotland Amendment Regulations 2020 SSI 2020-347. Cabinet Secretary, would you like to make any remarks on these SSIs before we take the motions?
No, I'd be happy just to move the motion.
Thank you. Are members content for these motions S5M23215 and S5M23366 to be moved en bloc? If any member is not content, please type N in the chat bar now. Members are agreed to move the motions en bloc. Can I now invite the Secretary to move en bloc motions S5M23215, that the COVID-19 Committee recommends that the Health Protection Coronavirus Restrictions and Requirements Local Levels Scotland Regulations 2020 SSI 2020-344 be approved, and motion S5M23366, that the COVID-19 Committee recommends that the Health Protection Coronavirus Restrictions and Requirements Local Levels Scotland Amendment Regulation 2020 SSI 2020-347 be approved.
Moved, convener.
Does any member wish to speak on either of the motions? And if so, could you please indicate by typing R in the chat box now? I note that no member has indicated that they wish to speak, so I will now put the question on the motions. The question is that the motion S5M23215 and motion S5M23366 be agreed to. Does any member disagree? And if so, please type N in the chat bar now. The motions are agreed to. The committee will publish a report to the Parliament setting out our decisions on the statutory instruments considered at this meeting in the coming days. That concludes our consideration of this agenda item and our time with the Cabinet Secretary this morning. I would like to thank the Cabinet Secretary and Professor Leach for their evidence, and I will now suspend this meeting to allow for a change over of witnesses. Members are advised that there is a time to have a short break during the suspension of up to 5 minutes, and we will reconvene in 15 minutes time at 10:40. Thank you. Thank you and welcome back to the meeting of the COVID-19 committee. We move to agenda item 3, the social and economic impact of restrictions over winter. And this morning, we're taking evidence from a range of stakeholders on the social, cultural and economic impact of possible restrictions on travel and social gatherings over the winter, particularly over the festive period. I would like to welcome to the meeting the following people: Dr. Liz Cameron, Director and Chief Executive at the Scottish Chamber of Commerce; Matt Crilly, National Union of Students Scotland President; William MacLeod, Executive Director, UK Hospitality Scotland; Adam Stokura, Head of Policy and Communications at Age Scotland; and Dr. Maureen Sear, Director at Interfaith Scotland. Can I welcome you all to this meeting? What I'd like to do is begin by asking each of our witnesses to give a brief opening remark and comment on any issues that they wish to raise with the committee on the subject matter I just detailed. And if I could ask you to do so in the order that I read you out. So to start with, can we please hear from Dr. Cameron from the Scottish Chamber of Commerce?
Thank you very much, Mr. Cameron, and to the committee for giving me this opportunity. There's no doubt about it that from a business point of view and economic point of view, our absolute priority was and still remains being able to trade as successfully as possible, but also as safely as possible. And I think it's worth mentioning, given some previous remarks, that businesses have invested millions and millions of pounds in making our environment safe and secure as far as is practically possible. And we also already have massive regulations, which we again follow in terms of making our premises safe and secure and following all appropriate regulations. I think that's important to just make that point. There's no doubt about it right now. Words that have been used in the last 24, 48 hours have been desperate, disillusioned, and a fatigue in terms of where is the light that we can all move forward to in order to be able to open up our trade as practically as possible. There is also an issue around obviously the travel restrictions. That is going to have major impact on not just our retailing and hospitality industries, although they will be the top ones that are suffering. But this issue of having our lights put on and then put off, this is now the third round of this as far as business is concerned. And many of them will now not be able to put our lights back on after these additional lockdowns that we are now we have been impacted on and will continue to be impacted on. So it is, whilst we understand the absolute intentions and we absolutely support looking after our people, looking after our employees, looking after our suppliers and our customers, we do challenge and question the plans and the reactive nature of the plans which have been put in place for business and our people, to which we care desperately about, and we have secured and have very, very safe environments. But that does not seem to be recognised. And we also are concerned and uncertain as to how the government are actually measuring movements from tier to tier in different geographical areas. The weighting of the economy and the buy-in which we got from everyone 3 weeks ago of the necessity to do this, we are now struggling to understand how the decisions have been driven and what data and evidence is being used. Get us all back on board as quickly as possible.
Thank you for that. Can I next turn to Mr. Crilly from the National Union of Students Scotland?
Hi there. Thanks for having me along today. So we, students have unwittingly found themselves, I think, at the heart of the COVID crisis in Scotland, and we support any measures to ensure student safety, staff safety, and the safety of our communities. I thought it was worth, starting on the winter break. So we really welcomed the Scottish Government's announcement for mass student testing. We think that it's central important for student welfare, and we supported it as a strategy to try and get students home for the winter break. We've had a really difficult term with many students, particularly those who stay in student accommodation, have had to self-isolate for extended periods. So this does give some real certainty for the students. And we've conducted mental health research that has shown that students often rely on family and friends for support networks. So it was really, we're really grateful to hear that the Scottish Government was considering mass asymptomatic testing to try and facilitate this move. We do need to make sure that students that remain staying in student accommodation are supported through the winter break. It could potentially be an isolating experience for those students. So we do need to make sure that support is available to them. More broadly, I was going to touch on some of the restrictions, and students have, you know, students often struggle with their mental health, and research that we conducted immediately prior to the pandemic showed that nearly half of students struggled with their mental health due to a lack of money or financial pressures. So the increasing restrictions on the likes of the hospitality industry, the retail sector, although, you know, completely understandable for public health safety reasons, and we support that, we just need to make sure that students are supported while these restrictions are introduced. Students often find themselves employed in these sectors. It can sometimes be some of the more precarious work within our society. So if restaurants and cafes are closed, then the tips and things that students often rely on to get by, they'll lose access to them. So we really welcome some of the move from the Scottish Government on the mass asymptomatic test on the student body. Really welcome. We're worried about mental health and the financial position that students find themselves in. And lastly, should probably touch on January. If we see a return to campus, we're not entirely sure what this is going to look like in January, but we really, really want to avoid the outbreaks, again, particularly student accommodation, that we saw in the late summer and the early autumn. We think that learning should be online as a default, and we should be really looking at the practical courses to see if we can deliver them in person. But students need a bit of clarity. We need to be following, you know, we need the public health officials to be looking into this so we can avoid what happened in the late summer.
Thank you for that. Can I next turn to Mr. McLeod from UK Hospitality Scotland?
Good morning, Mr. Cameron. Morning, everybody. And thank you again for the opportunity to speak to the committee this morning. First of all, I think from a business perspective and indeed a hospitality industry perspective, I'd endorse much of what Liz Cameron and Matt have already said in relation to hospitality. I think the main issues I'd like to mention up front are perhaps just an overview that clearly COVID's had a huge impact on our businesses, on turnover, on profit, on viability, have little or no cash flow. They've unbalanced their balance sheets by incurring additional borrowing. They've coped with constant change, often at short notice. And, I think Dr. Cameron mentioned the investment in safety and PPE for our industry in Scotland. We think that amounts to probably between 80 and 90 million pounds. But I think there's also been an impact on our staff through loss of jobs and income, and Matt touched on that point. Our chief executive gave evidence yesterday to the Westminster Business Committee, and she was saying that we think from ONS data and our own surveys that 600,000 jobs have been lost or remain at risk in hospitality. That would translate to about 50,000 in Scotland. And earlier this year, I was estimating that we could have as many as 70 to 100,000 jobs in hospitality at risk in Scotland. To put that in context, the wider hospitality industry employs 285,000 people. I think I would also touch on the impact on our customers who have been denied normal social activity. life events, travel restrictions, restrictions on leisure day trips for the family, the inability to take holidays, the impact on local and business customers. Last week, we saw impacts on the ability of people to celebrate Diwali. We're looking forward with considerable uncertainty to the festive period. I can say more perhaps later about the impact on business if there's an opportunity, but we're publishing a survey later today that will show that businesses think at level zero in Scotland, they will trade at about 72% of last year's level. And that declines to 13% of last year's level at level four. So there's significant impact on viability and profit under the current five levels in Scotland. Looking ahead, the industry really needs ongoing sector-specific support. We don't think we're going to see much recovery in 2021. We think it will begin 2022. We need to look at the adequacy of support to meet the costs, the fixed costs of closure, and not just the fixed costs when businesses are closed. There's a cost associated with actually closing down and reopening a business, and these are quite significant. The principal issues we need to help us get through this are an extension of the business rates holiday, an extension of the reduction in VAT, which of course is a reserve matter, the ability of tenants in rented property to be protected from repossessions. And I think in closing, I would say that the hospitality, the tourism industry is an innovative and resilient industry. And given the opportunity to trade at normal levels, our industry will recover quickly. We begin to employ people, we'll kickstart our extensive supply chain, and we'll quickly contribute to public sector revenues through the taxes we collect. So I should finish there and thank you for the opportunity to give that summary.
Thank you. Can I next turn to Mr. Takura from Age Scotland?
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for the invitation to join this committee. I'll be quite brief in this. I think a fair bit was put in our written submission, although that was also brief. But there's no doubt that COVID's had a massive impact on all of our lives, but particularly devastating for older people in Scotland when you look at the high levels of death rates across those people over 75, three-quarters of all deaths are of that age group, and about half of all deaths in care home. Winter's going to be a really difficult time for older people. And it's something that we anticipated back in the summer, the necessity to look forward and have an action plan for winter so that older people could be supported through this. And one of our primary and principal concerns here is the quite seems like an astronomical level of loneliness and isolation, which has been prevalent throughout this year, which is only going to increase through the winter months with shorter days and poorer weather and all of the restrictions that are in place. Of course, there's a really fine line here. The Scottish Government have to tread and health officials on protecting lives and health and public health, but also quality of life is hugely important as well. So with regard to loneliness and isolation, you know, not that everyone will be in this category, but there's 350,000 pensioners in Scotland who live alone. Last Christmas, our research demonstrated that over 100,000 older people ate their Christmas lunch alone. And this figure, we imagine, will increase exponentially, and that's equivalent to one older person every street. Before this crisis, 200,000 would go at least half a week without seeing or hearing from anyone. We know that has gone up. And one of the big things we'd like to see going forward, this is really important, is making sure that all older people have the support available to them if they require it going through these next few months. And this could look at access to medical treatment, which might be quite challenging for people to get to or even to access in the first place, also depending on which tier of local authority they live in, or indeed where they are sort of shielding, like, you know, while the shielding service and system is essentially stopped, there are people who are in that category who feel that they need to continue maintain doing so. So all the services and all the support that was put in place as a response to the first lockdown it's really important that this is able to be turned back on at a moment's notice so folks are able to have a good quality of life. I'll leave you with that.
Thank you. Thank you, Adam. And finally, can I next turn to Dr. Sia from Interfaith Scotland?
Thank you, convener, and thank you, COVID Committee, for this opportunity to say a few words. Everything that's been said really echoes with the faith communities. People who are members of faith communities are not very different to the rest of society and involved in all sorts of things, from businesses to being elderly, etc. But at the heart of faith is the whole sense of community. And I think this has been really particularly difficult for the faith communities, that the idea of getting together and, you know, going to the mosque on Friday in big numbers, going to the Gurdwara as a huge community hub, the synagogue, the churches, etc. That whole sense of what it means to be a faith community and all the support that people get by being together. Of course, that has been taken away from the faith communities, and rites of passage such as and marriages and funerals and all the things that faith communities really do see to, along with, of course, the humanist society who are also doing marriages and funerals, and just how complicated that can be, you know, when you have the expectations of families to deal with, when those expectations just can't be met because of the pandemic. So that's a big burden, I think, on faith communities, although they have been incredibly resilient, and there has been great dialogue with the Scottish Government and the faith communities about things like reopening places of worship safely and making sure that there can be limited engagement with community gatherings and with places of worship so that people can come together. And that guidance has been really, really helpful to the faith communities. It's already been mentioned just the impact on the elderly, and many of the faith communities have an elderly population. I think that's been mentioned in some of the written submissions already from the faith communities. And they're not necessarily connected online, and so their loneliness and isolation is just exacerbated. All faith communities that I know, you know, that engage with Interfaith Scotland, which is a huge and wide range of faith communities, have moved just about everything online and have done that really creatively and dynamically. But there are still those that are not able to do that, to connect in an online environment. So they miss that community connection. It impacts on their mental health. All the things that have been mentioned already impact on the faith communities of Scotland. There are festivals going forward, Guru Nanak's birthday, Hanukkah, and of course the festival of Christmas. And although that's a festival perhaps of the Christian community, I think it has huge cultural implications on how that is handled and managed. And I know that this particular lockdown at the moment and the tier system is in order to sort of free people up perhaps to come together for that religious and cultural festival. And the faith communities have been incredibly supportive of all that that the Scottish Government is trying to do to keep people safe and to keep people as looked after as they possibly can be. I wanted to just touch very briefly as well on funds. Some of the minority faith communities, the way that they pay for example, their priest would be through donations. Say at the Hindu temple, for example, donations that would be received on a weekly basis actually pays the wage of the priest. So that has been removed because they can't have large numbers at the temple. So there is some financial struggle with the faith communities. And again, appreciation for small grant funds that the Scottish Government has made available to make sure that all the PPE and the cleaning of places of worship and the ability for faith communities to come together, albeit in small numbers, has been much appreciated. So going forward, it's very hard to imagine how things are going to change. There's the continuing support for the faith communities is much appreciated. Taking care of the lonely and the vulnerable and co-collaborating with the faith communities when there's guidance that's being prepared and you know that the communities themselves have to implement that guidance. So I think that's been really, really effective and very much appreciated. But everything that's impacting in all the other sectors of society and impacts on the faith communities as well. Thank you.
Thank you for that, and thank you all for those very useful and illuminating comments. What we're going to do now is bring in other members of the committee, and just to advise everyone, if you want to come in at a certain point, the best way to do that is to type R in the chat box, and I'll try and take as many people as possible. Obviously, we are time limited, so we'll just try and get everyone in if we can. And also, can I ask members, as ever, to direct, if they want to direct a specific question to a specific witness, please to do so when they ask their question. So first, can I turn to Monica Lennon, the Deputy Convener?
Thank you, Convener, and thank you to our panel for really helpful opening remarks. There's lots of questions and not a lot of time, so I'll just try and pick out a few and maybe return later if there is time in hand, Convener. If I can start with the economic and business support side of it, it's really been good to hear both Dr. Cameron and Mr. McLeod. I suppose my question is that given that we've now got, you know, a lot of areas of Scotland under level four, and we know that businesses rely on the run-up to Christmas and the holiday season itself. So can I ask if there are estimates of what the losses will be to, I suppose, retail and hospitality who will be hit the hardest as a result of level four, and what you think the impact on jobs will be? And I was struck by what Dr. Cameron said about, I suppose, the challenges around the reactive nature of some of these plans. So can I just ask, because others have said that there's been good dialogue and consultation with the government, including Dr. Sear, who spoke a moment ago, is that still not happening well enough between the business community and government? I'll maybe come to Dr. Cameron first on that, and then to Mr. McLeod. Dr. Cameron first on that, and then to Mr. McLeod.
Okay, thank you for that. Those points, Monica. Can you hear me all right?
Yeah.
Thank you for that. First of all, in terms of the estimates, it's quite interesting. We did carry out a recent survey amongst our members, and it's still ongoing, where we were asking questions about the strategic framework and the various tier levels. In particular about the financial support, with over 68% of the survey respondents indicating that they believed that the financial support was, first of all, not appropriate and didn't even scratch the surface in terms of a number of businesses who are now entering, as I said, their second or third lockdown. So the financial support is absolutely not sufficient. Whilst furlough is being hailed as being the panacea for everything, it's, you know, it's absolutely stopped or delayed the job losses that we're expecting to hit in November, beginning of December. And obviously, with it being extended, that has been helpful. But we've got to understand that that does make up a lower percentage of our basic costs of running and opening our doors, because we've got rent, we have rates, we have hiring of equipment, we have loan repayments, employers NI, and this all adds up. And therefore, you know, the business support, although it sounds, you know, one-liners of £30 million announced yesterday, you know, business this morning and late last night still did not know how to apply, still didn't know the process to apply, and that's been a pattern which has been received since the start of many lockdowns. Local authorities didn't even know what guidance that they should be following, except it's discretionary. The possibility of the funding hitting business may not happen for another 2 weeks. Businesses can't wait that long. So there's been a pattern there, and we have fed that back, and we have had lots of opportunities to learn, i.e. the initial close down of Aberdeen. So, you know, my ask is that a lot of this learning, and when we're making policy announcements, we absolutely must make certain that the process is ready immediately after that announcement, because there's an expectation being created by business community who are already desperate, as I said, and we're now having to sit and wait until when to actually understand whether we can apply. We know that the local authorities, but irrespective of which tier you're in, is it going to apply to those areas that are in tier four? Is it going to apply to those areas who are in tier two? Because it's interesting about tourism, because although areas that are in tier two and tier three, and Willie will confirm this, due to the high volume of their customers coming from other parts of Scotland, and in some cases as high as 90%, you know, you've got businesses in the borders that are sandwiched between different tiers, many of whom have decided this morning we're closing, even though they're not in a tier where that restriction is there. They are being forced to close with the horrendous situation of our employees now being left with, you know, the potential of now being out of a job, with everything that means. So the mental health and well-being, it's not just business, it's the business community, and it's also the employees that rely on us being able to keep our doors open. So there needs to be, and there should have been, an awful lot more forward planning, because we, you know, the government have been looking at this for we're now into month nine, probably governments, but we're talking about Scotland for a moment. There needs to be a bit more forward planning, because they have the intelligence, they have the data, they have the information. You know, we're struggling to understand why we're getting 3 days' notice. We are struggling to understand why even those areas that are going down from tier three into tier two, that's not happening for another week. Why? In terms of business engagement, at the outset of this horrendous pandemic facing us all as human beings, we and many other business organisations have thrown everything we've got at working in partnership with the Scottish Government. We have influenced them in a number of areas. We have given our guidance when that was required, and we'll continue to do so, because we are all in this together. And the butt's coming now. Can that engagement be improved? Absolutely. And we are just commencing our discussion with the Scottish Government and its officials in terms of how we can potentially map out a future flow of engagement, quality engagement, not just consultation. We need to go up our level in terms of, you can consult, you can tick a box. I'm not saying that's happening, but you can be ticking boxes. We've got to redesign the engagement and partnership between our parliamentarians and whoever's leading a government at a particular time with business, because we will not survive this if we don't focus on that area and focus on testing and improving and investing in testing in Scotland. We want as many business premises as possible to be able to initiate testing. It's, you know, that's where the investment needs to go. That's where the priority should be going. Because I'm not convinced that even the restrictions that are now being placed upon us, you know, didn't work the last time round, and I'm not convinced yet that this constant closing businesses down is the answer, because it's quite clear where the pinch points of the growth of the virus, and that is in home environment, where unfortunately none of us have the real levers to be able to close homes down, really. So therefore we need to, I think, redesign how we're developing our future plans and our exit strategy.
Thank you, Dr. Cameron. That's all really, really helpful. Can I come to Willie McLeod, please?
Yes. Thank you, Ms. Lennon. I think, to put an absolute figure per each of the five levels in Scotland, I think what I'd preface what I'm about to say by saying clearly I'm speaking about the situation the hospitality industry finds itself in Scotland, but really the situation is no different in any other of the component parts of the UK. Much of what I'm saying today, my colleagues are saying at Westminster and in Cardiff and indeed in Belfast. So this is very much a UK-wide issue, and we need to look at the recovery of hospitality and indeed tourism at a UK-wide level. But the best illustration I could give, and I think Liz, I'm not sure who stole whose script this morning, but I would endorse everything that Liz said in the last couple. If I look at the survey we had the results of last night, that if we look across the hospitality sector, as a whole in Scotland, the response is that at level four, 75% of the businesses responding to the survey said that they would no longer be viable. That, to me, suggests they're on the point of closure. 19% reported that they would operate at a loss. Only 3% thought they would reach break even, and only 3% thought they would return a profit. Now, clearly, the impact is less at the other four levels, with level zero being representing a much more positive outlook. But there is no doubt that hospitality businesses are in really deep trouble. We have a number of business types that haven't been able to reopen since first lockdown. These include music venues, they include meeting and conference centres, they include nightclubs. These businesses are in deep trouble. Every pound that government, whether it's at Holyrood or Westminster, allocates to our industry is welcome. But the sad fact is that even with support through 100% relief on business rates, a reduction in VAT, we're still in trouble. Our revenues are not growing. Our cash flow is really in a dire strait. If we look, for example, at the grants currently available, and I'd endorse again what Liz says, that we need a lot more detail about the current financial support. But we're really looking at somewhere between £1,500 and £4,000 per 4 weeks in terms of grant support for businesses that are closed. And I think we've also got to think about businesses that are effectively closed because regulations have such an impact on their ability to trade that it's tantamount to closing them down. The business model effectively gets severely constrained because of the restrictions. But comparing the grants available to the fixed costs of closure, the average hotel in Scotland incurs £62,000 in fixed costs when it's closed. The average medium-sized pub, between £6,000 and £10,000 a month in fixed costs when closed. And there are costs related to actually closing down. There's stock written off, and then there are costs when the business is reopened. So we really need financial support that matches the costs being suffered by these businesses. Otherwise, they just won't survive, and we won't have an industry to deal with recovery when that comes. Furlough helps, and we very much welcome the extension of furlough till the end of March. That gives us some breathing space, and it may be that we need that to continue. But I think it's important to realise that furlough quite rightly provides an underpinning of the income of individuals who are affected by the pressures on our businesses, but it doesn't actually put money into the cash registers of the businesses. They still have to meet a share of employment costs, and they still have to bear the costs of businesses that are closed. So really, we need to look at how we're going to adequately support businesses moving forward. I think just in closing, in response to your question, I think government, both at Westminster and at Holyrood, has engaged well with the industry. But it's a question of how you define engagement and consultation. I'm not sure that we've had the extent of meaningful consultation allowing a real contribution from the business community into the regulations, the pace at which they're introduced. There's been quite a lot of dialogue on guidance, but we believe that with proper consultation, we could make a contribution to the decisions that government's reaching. We could help get it right first time, and we could maybe iron out some of the unintended consequences, as has been very evident in relation to, for example, licensing law.
Thank you to William McLeod here. The first answers were very long but very useful. So if I can just come very, very briefly to the remaining witnesses this morning. We've heard a lot about the impact of business closures, what that could mean for job losses, and that adds to the uncertainty and the poor mental health that we've heard others talk about already. If I can come to Matt Kelly and to Adam Secura and Dr. Sear, just to say briefly, there's obviously a lot of hype and focus on the festival of Christmas because, you know, whether you're of Christian faith or not, it doesn't matter to a lot of people. It is about togetherness. There's a lot of pressure on people to have a normal Christmas and to be together and to be happy and joyful and to be grateful for that for whatever time we might get together. But at the same time, we're hearing that there's going to be a lot of economic pain and uncertainty about jobs, which we know for hospitality affects a lot of younger workers. But we also know that we have a lot of age discrimination in this country already. So for older workers, they'll be worried too. So in a nutshell, can you each maybe name one thing that government could do and is in more of a role for the third sector who are close to communities, the third sector and our faith communities, to support people who might be struggling with mental health, loneliness and isolation? I'll come to Matt first because you appear to be on the screen.
thank you. So, you know, one of the crucial things that the government could do just now to try and help students through these restrictions, again, particularly in the areas of the economy which are being hit hardest, where students work. You know, you think about where all the restrictions are coming in, it's where students work, is we need to see more investment in discretionary funding to help students. The Scottish Government's own research, which they published on the 30th of October, noted that our educational institutions had reported significant financial hardship being reported from their students who had lost their employment opportunities, the income of their families had declined, and of course, most students aren't eligible for universal credit. So when our income gets hit, it really gets hit. It's a real struggle. So we need to see more investment in discretionary funding so that universities and colleges can help support students. And then in terms of what the third sector could do, we've also been calling for investment into student associations, universities and colleges to try and help students get through particularly this winter period. You know, for the students that are on campus just now, this is the time of the year that students have exams. It's when our final assessments are due. You know, the lockdown is difficult. The best of times when you're in the middle of your exams, it's a lot harder when you can't get a break from the intensity of that. We would quite like to see investment in student associations, universities and colleges to try and help students. Again, particularly for those that will stay in the accommodation over the winter months. We have care experience students, estranged students, international students where their halls is their home. They're not going, you know, home for Christmas, they're not going back for the winter break. And it's a really vulnerable time. So we need to make sure that there's investment so that they get some sort of wellbeing support, they get access to food and drink if they have to self-isolate and things like that. So that would be my contribution.
Thanks, Matt. Really important. I'm getting in trouble now, so if I can ask Adam Secura and Dr. Sear to be really brief. Sorry to race through it because your points are really important. We appreciate it.
Hey, thanks, Robert. I will be very brief. Really the point there about older workers. Obviously, younger workers are the group that most impacted economically in terms of this, but the second group our older workers, we've got an ageing population, we've got a rising sort of retirement age, we have people who haven't enough kind of retirement savings to live on and will have real difficulties in the future. Furlough has been hugely important because for those people who are working, we've been able to kind of be sort of delay, kind of maybe laid off, but actually it gives hope that they can continue in employment. Big challenges there. So can't forget about that group. They're not having it easy by any stretch. But the one thing government could do in looking at this is actually looking at the festive period or the December sort of period is there's a big challenge here for community groups who would normally be kind of helping tackle this isolation, making sure people had access to food and kind of for malnourishment and all the rest of it. These things are closed. The doors are closed because they can't operate. They're largely run by voluntary organisations who don't have maybe the right kind of support to be able to do so. They also maybe don't have the kind of guidance to be able to kind of keep the doors open. So these are places throughout Christmas that are really going to struggle to be able to support people across the country. So what we really need then is a package of, you know, kind of support, not just financial, but in-person support for community groups and organisations to be able to operate for all these people who are going to be isolated and lonely and have a real difficult time going forward.
Thank you. Dr. Steer.
Oh, sorry, yeah, I was just waiting for that. Thanks. I'm going to take a slightly different approach and say that I would really encourage the Scottish Government to see the Faith Communities of Scotland as an incredible resource. I think already they have demonstrated just how able and committed they are to supporting the lonely and the vulnerable and the isolated through all kinds of things, food banks, massive food delivery. They know their communities, and although just over 50% of the Scottish population are affiliated in some way with a faith community, that's a lot of people, and there's a lot of volunteers in faith communities. There's structures, there's buildings, there's religious leaders that are listened to. The way that the messaging gets out there to the communities, you're really reaching, well, like I say, at least 50% of the population. And it's going to be really, really important, the messaging that comes out around particularly the Christmas festival, but all festivals, as I say, Hanukkah's coming up and the birthday of Guru Nanak and other festivals too, but how the Scottish Government I guess faith communities are built on things like inspiration and all that. How are we going to inspire people to see that the festive period can still be festive, but in a very different way to what we're used to? And there's going to be massive disappointment. There's going to be challenges. And I was really touched by what they said about 100,000 elderly people eating Christmas dinner on their own. One of the things that the COVID pandemic has really shown us is that that people are prepared to reach out to their neighbours now. They're really prepared to open their metaphorical doors, if not open their literal doors, to try to phone someone who's lonely and isolated. And the faith communities have very, very much done that. You know, they've set up whole networks, communication networks to ensure that everyone who's on their books that lives on their own gets a call or is supported to know how to engage with technology. So see the faith community as a resource. It doesn't mean that they're not vulnerable. It doesn't mean that they're not going to be struggling, disappointed and, short of money and all the things that everybody else has. But I think I would just point to the fact that they are also an incredible resource, and that get the messaging right and get the make sure that the faith communities are getting that messaging out to their respective and very diverse communities. And one final tiny little thing to say is just not to take our eye off the ball of things like hate crime. While all of this is going on, there's still hate crimes being committed towards those that are perceived as other or different. So not to take our eye off that ball either.
Thank you, convener.
Thank you very much. Before I turn to Stuart McMillan for his questions, can I just make the point that we have about an hour left and six members of the committee still to ask questions. So can I just ask a slightly briefer answers to the questions? And also just to remind everyone, we do have submissions from all the organisations that are present on the panel today. And the focus of the session is on winter and a festive period, rather on the sort of general effects of COVID. And I know that it's hard to untangle that sometimes, but just to remind people of that. And that's not to say in on any view that the answers that we've had have not been useful. They've been incredibly helpful. But if we could just sort of slightly focusing. So with that wrap on the knuckles, can I turn next to Stuart McMillan?
Thank you very much, Convener. It's just a question for both Dr. Cameron and Willie McLeod. In the submission from UK Hospitality, as Mr. McLeod touched upon the current extension of the current restrictions, but and welcomes that they'll be reviewed each week. And in Dr. Cameron's submission, it's a part highlighting the support interventions must be directed by real-time data and business intelligence. With the review taking place every week and based upon the most up-to-date data, do both panellists, do they consider that approach to be the correct approach? Also, I am very much aware that this is the most important quarter for retail, for the hospitality trade. Would they want to see a different mechanism going forward? Dr. Cameron first.
I was hoping you wouldn't ask that, Stuart, that for me to go first, but thank you very much. The weekly reviews, yes, I think that's the weekly review is appropriate and that should remain. Unless leading into the Christmas period that we are seeing very quick decreases in the spread, then we would hope that possibly if that trajectory is being reached, that we could look at less reviews more reviews in terms of within a week. But I don't think that's going to be possible given that the data that the Scottish Government, I think, are working towards, and the experts are telling us they're a week behind question mark in some cases, then it means we're probably working at times 2 weeks behind the ball. So I don't have the knowledge to be able to say, could it be done quicker and faster? So I'll stick with the weekly reviews. In terms of real-time data, our economic data is always, if we use the normal sources of information, it always lags behind, but they have got the opportunity, the government, to actually have daily calls with the business community. Although we are many, many different business organisations, I have to say that in this situation, leading into the festive period, we are all of the same view in terms of the impact it's making. So, if we do manage to, sit down on a more regular basis with key ministers and those making the decisions, I think that would be more helpful.
Mr. McLeod?
Yes, mindful of the need for brevity, much chastised am I. I think the winter period is our businesses and our customers. I think the importance of the one weekly review is that provided the data the government is using is up to date, and particularly for businesses that find themselves in level four, they could perhaps get a direction of travel. I think we've been told that the current levels will apply until the 11th of December. Now, if you're in a business in level four, you will want to know what the direction of travel is. Are you likely to be staying in level four, or might you move out of level four? And that applies, I think, right down the levels, the risk of those who might be moving up a level. So I think regular weekly information would be quite useful. I think the critical part is that for these businesses, the winter period is critical to their turnover and the profitability, and many are not going to experience that this year.
I mean, certainly just on that, obviously Mr. McLeod knows that I chaired the cross-party group on tourism and we discussed many aspects of hospitality in the past and will continue to do so going forward. On the issue of the travel ban that is touched upon also in some of the submissions, where there are areas that have that higher level of the higher level of COVID as compared to neighbouring authorities, which might be in a lower tier. And do the panellists think, particularly once again, Mr. McLeod and Dr. Cameron, that the panellists think that actually that there is a way to try to protect the areas that have a lower level of COVID by accepting that the travel restrictions are actually the correct thing to do? This time, Mr. McLeod first.
I can understand fully understand and appreciate the reason for travel restrictions, and indeed the reports that they could well be enforced legally. I think there's no doubt that the travel restrictions are placing a significant additional burden on those businesses that would otherwise want to be open at this time of year. It has resulted in cancellations. It puts certain pressure on businesses in trying to decide whether or not they should be accepting a reservation from a particular group or family. And I think there's a lot of responsibility needs to be placed on private individuals to respect the restrictions that are placed on them. I don't think this is something that businesses themselves can monitor.
Yeah. Dr. Cameron?
Our position is that we would like to have seen the travel restrictions remaining as guidance and encouraging behaviours to comply with it, rather than a legislative approach which has just been approved, I understand. We don't agree with that. I think that we would rather, and remain to be convinced, but we would rather see some evidence that's quite clearly showing not just the geographical areas, but which events are actually causing the growth in these areas where the virus is increasing. What's causing that? What percentage of the growth is coming from which events and where in a geographical area? Because we're not fully convinced that individuals travelling is actually the high percentage of how the virus is being transmitted.
Thank you. And just one final point before I move on, convener, to allow others in. I think that your point there, Dr. Cameron, regarding the events, I think is a very, very valid one, because also in recent weeks we've seen obviously some major sporting events, as well as the bonfire night, which those numbers haven't really permeated. Certainly, bonfire hasn't really permeated into the figures yet, and I'm thinking about my own constituency there. But certainly, in terms of sporting events and being shown on television, there may end up being some type of pattern that actually ties in with that. But in addition to something that people do every single week, buying to supermarkets and shopping, particularly the larger supermarkets, which clearly people have to go to purchase food. So that was actually one of the reasons why I posed the question in the earlier session, because of the concerns that were raised with me by a staff member in one of those supermarkets. Mm-hmm. But I'm fine, Commissioner. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Our next question has come from Mark Ruskell.
Yeah, thanks very much, convener. And I wanted to ask Matt Crilly actually about something that he mentioned in his opening statement, and that was about the move to online learning, or perhaps even blended learning as the default. I mean, obviously, you'd be aware, Matt, that there are concerns with some institutions, particularly St Andrews University, that in August, effectively face-to-face teaching was the default. And I'm just wondering, how have the universities and colleges moved on from that in the last few months? And is there really certainty now for students about what they'll be coming back to in January? And I suppose that you know, in my mind, sort of thinking about, well, students have got this right under the COVID regulations to cancel their leases within 28 days. And many of them must be thinking right now, well, actually, you know, should I be going back into halls in January? Or if it's all going to be online learning, why don't I just do it from home?
Yeah, I think my worry at the moment is we haven't learned the lessons from September and October. So I don't think students do have the certainty as to what their teaching is going to look like in January. And in fact, it seems like some, again, particular universities where there's a financial imperative for institutions to want to have students arrive because otherwise they would suffer a loss of international tuition fee income, potentially rental income from students. And I don't think students actually have the certainty yet as to what their teaching will look like in January. Some institutions are still promising a blended learning approach where students will be expected to arrive for some in-person delivery, perhaps some online delivery. And again, we are worried about that because I think you are right at the moment. I think students will be considering what they want to do for the winter break. Some might be considering, you know, do I just want to go back permanently? But in order to make that informed decision, you kind of need to know what January is going to look like. And I don't think students do have the certainty at the moment. I think it's really hard for us to plan. We don't know what the pandemic will look like. We don't know how the virus will spread. But I do think students would really value some medium-term certainty as to what their learning will look like. And I do think things, you know, that can easily be done online should be done online to try and help mitigate some of that transmission.
Yeah. Are there particular institutions where they're hedging their bets and not really telling students whether it's all going to be online or not at the moment? Or can you at least point to other universities who are giving students the clarity, if that's more difficult?
Well, I'm not sure if I want to land individual institutions in it at the moment. I do think this is a sector problem, though. This actually isn't necessarily one institution doing one thing, the other doing another. This is a very much a sectoral issue where it seems like we're kind of all in one basket here where, again, there's talk of kind of blended learning coming in on January. I do know some institutions that are promising that. And I think students will look at it perhaps with some degree of scepticism as to whether it will be possible if the virus is where it is now. I don't know if we know it will be significantly safer for us to be on campus for in-person delivery come January, again in the peak of winter.
Does that need clearer guidance from government then?
Definitely. We think there should be a strengthening of the guidance. Actually, the new Tier 4 guidance states that everything that can be done online should be done online, and only the most essential, practical-based, placement-based learning, that has to take place in person should. We think that that's a sensible approach, you know, given the fact we're in this pandemic.
Okay, thanks for that. Can I just quickly turn to our business representatives? I was reading some of the submissions, and I think, you know, that there's obviously the hope that we're going to have an economic recovery. And I think one of the submissions talked about the potential for a sort of a K-shaped recovery, effectively where, you know, there'll be winners, there'll be substantial winners where sectors will be able to adapt and grow, but there'll be others that are really going to struggle. And I guess I'd sort of point to some of the sort of larger corporations like Tesco. Tesco's profits in the first half of this year, between March and August, went up by nearly 30%. Amazon's profits, for example, went up 35% last year, and I suspect they'll be a lot higher this year. And that's before we've even got to the golden quarter of retail sales. So I just want to ask the business representatives about that. I mean, do you see a growing inequality between the larger corporates and the small business sector? And what do you think we should be doing about that? Should we be attempting to try and perhaps introduce a windfall tax or a kind of, you know, a business rates levy on those larger organizations that are perhaps being incentivized in a way through the current lockdown arrangements because they're selling essential goods and they're able to sell other goods to consumers as well. Maybe direct that at Liz to start with.
Thank you very much, Mark. In terms of the different models of doing business now, that's been driven by, as we all know, food and drink. Their sales have gone dramatically up, and they have also gone dramatically up over the last 10 days with lockdowns, because our behaviours are driving that. But whilst we may not go out, or where the restrictions in restaurants, no alcohol, so people are buying more alcohol. And apparently, I just heard this morning, the sales of a particular drink, the sales of a particular drink has gone dramatically up in the last week. That itself is storing major problems for us post-COVID. That's not the remit of this group. But so I would say that the whole way in which we shop, the whole way in which we engage and interact, and the way we live and work, and that's driving all of those increases in consumers and consumer behaviour. That's going to continue. But in terms of your question about, what do we do with that? That's, we've got some businesses that are absolutely, IT is another sector that's absolutely increased substantially in the last 9 months because of that, the hybrid models of us working. What do we do about that? Do we leave it to market forces? In a free economy that we're in, my inclination, probably gathered, probably would be that. My butt's coming now, and that is that, having said that, small businesses in particular are really, really struggling and have been for some time. Many have already lost not just their jobs and their businesses, but the sheer focus on their livelihoods. I would say that we do need to look at how we can help support those entrepreneurs, because whether you're a sole trader or not, in my book, you're a key entrepreneur. How can we give support to perhaps helping those individuals to look at restarting new businesses? Because although the big corporates, and in particular the retailers that you've mentioned there, yes, they have increased their turnover, but they've also changed their business models, and they've also invested in changing that business model. But with that, new supply chains have been created. So, can we encourage and have a roundtable discussion looking at what the new economy is going to look like, quarter one and quarter two in Scotland, and how can we help support the diversification, whether that's where the funding comes from? I don't want to go into that right now, but how can we look at supporting and creating these new opportunities for those individuals and those businesses who have employees that are actually, quite frankly, their business model is just slumped and cannot ever be restarted again. So that's the kind of focus that, in terms of, we should be having now. We should be planning that now, ready for helping to restart and give people hope that we can restart our businesses. May not be in the same business we were in before, but giving them hope that they can actually, work with government and government officials. And that's where's the business support being focused at? What level of investment is being placed in? And is it working? Or do we have to revisit where the investment's been spent?
I mean, governments are always going to have limits on how much they can invest in small businesses and support that economic recovery. Would you not want to see even a small amount of Tesco's £554 million profit from the first 6 months of this year being spent on investing in small high street retailers?
I think that's where what I'm saying is that, if I was at Tesco sitting here, I'm sure that they've got A, shareholders, and B, they would say, well, we're paying more corporation tax to government. They could say that, reverting back to you at the moment, Mark. Having said that, I do think that there could be an opportunity to have a level of a conversation with Scotland PLC to say, what can we now do together that's going to help, might be a short-term lift, that's going to help restart that economy. I think that, we've got Young Persons Guarantee, we've got the Kickstart programme, many businesses already supporting the government initiatives that are coming through to us on that by helping to not create a job, which probably isn't there right now, but we're already doing that, and that's with the heart and minds that we believe in our communities. So there's elements of different ways of gotten PLC supporting others and supporting their communities, and that should have, and there could be an opportunity to have that conversation.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you, Mark. Can I turn next to Willie Coffey, please?
Thanks very much, Convener. Just two questions from me, please. One to Matt and one, I think, to Liz. Matt, when you were talking at the beginning, you told us a wee bit about some mental health research that had been carried out, or maybe is in the process of being carried out, I'm not quite sure. Are there any key messages emerging from that that you can share with us at the moment, particularly as we're running up to Christmas and New Year, which is clearly an important time for everybody, not least all our students. So is there any messages coming for that you can share with the committee and what we might be able to do to help?
Yeah, thanks, Willie. This was research that was carried out that we commissioned just prior to the pandemic. So it was all conducted just prior to the pandemic, and we released it around 3 weeks ago or so. But there, I think there is some real lessons from it, because it does point to basically some of the crunch points of poor mental health among students. So 72% of students cited that it was their first year of study as being a time where they had concerns about their mental health and well-being. Now, you know, what does that mean for us just now? That look at who's in the student accommodation, where we've seen the virus outbreaks. You know, it's predominantly first year students who might be 17, 18 years old, and we know that they are. You know, nearly three quarters of students said that was the time where they struggled with their mental health was in that first year. So that's a big worry coming into the winter break for those students that are in the student accommodation. Some were struggling to cope with workload. Around half of students struggled to cope with workload. Again, more than half had to wait for access to the support that they needed. But yeah, some of the findings again were the winter time is a time where students do struggle, because it's when their assignments, etc., come in. And again, the more than half of students, so 59% of students reported that they turned to their friends for informal mental health support, and 54% said they turned to their family for informal support to get through with poor mental health. So I think, you know, the lessons learned, I think, is positive, the moves we've seen from the Scottish Government to try and safely get students back for those who wish to go home for the winter break, and doing that through the test, and I think that's really welcome. The real thing that we would ask for is some funding to be made available to support those students that remain in student accommodation, that remain in the private flats around campus, to make sure that they have access to some sort of again, enhanced mental health support and wellbeing support and some sort of social side. It's true, student associations normally in normal years put on things like Christmas dinners for the students that are left kind of isolated in their accommodation. That's of course going to be harder this year, but I think there's a lot of really supportive things that we could do.
That's really good. Thanks for that, Matt. I wonder if I could ask a question to Liz again. Please, Convener. Liz, we're coming up to the Christmas New Year period, we all know that, and we're in the second wave of this virus. As a constituency MSP, I was absolutely inundated with inquiries from small businesses right across Kilmarnock and Irvine Valley, many of whom said we don't qualify for any assistance or support as part of the official government schemes. Has the Chamber been able at all to assess any of that, the impact of that, and do you think we're in a better position now with a lot of parts of Scotland moving to level 4 to be able to help those businesses that might have fallen through the schemes in the first place so that it doesn't happen again this time round?
Mm-hmm. No, I think we've improved, really, because when we entered this it was, you know, big announcements out, and I don't think that we fully understood the assets that we have and the fragility of some of the businesses that are around. So I think we've learned from that. But there was, where there were gaps, particularly in with sole traders or, you know, tourism companies or food suppliers or events consultants, you know, that are on their own. All of those individuals, and there's hundreds and thousands of them, all fell through the gap. Now, we lobbied the UK government where it was appropriate, and we also highlighted and lobbied the Scottish government. We've had some movement in the last couple of weeks where we've managed to get those individuals incorporated into some of the grants, but there are still gaps, and that's when we look at the discretionary funding that's been announced. Let's be clear where that funding is going to, because debt sectors like, you know, those, you know, 1-2 person businesses and small retailing tourism organisations that are on our high streets, that are family businesses, they've not had access to any funding whatsoever. You've got small businesses that are looking after playgroups and play centres. They have still, now there's movement in that direction, but the last 8 months they've had nothing. And in fact, I know we're in a rush, but you know, there's a hospitality industry was in the Highlands, and he sent me an email. He says, we're now in quite a needy position with nothing to apply to, no forms to fill in, and no more battles to fight. It's like a sudden fall over the cliff. We hear what's happening. We're on the receiving end of the new laws and restrictions, but the focus is on those who are actually in the restricted areas. What about those who are not, as well as being in Tier 4? There's two or three others there that I've got that we're pulling together to present to Scottish Government. So there are still gaps. Yes, the announcement will now include taxi drivers. You know, that's a massive group. The playgroup areas, they employ nearly 5,000 people across Scotland. So there have been gaps, there are still gaps, and they need to be filled very, very quickly. We've been saying that for a long time, and we've already lost a lot of businesses as a result. So when I hear people saying we're working at pace, you know, I'm not quite sure what that pace is. You know, businesses need money now, not waiting for 2 weeks' time, because they can't survive now. Over the leading into the point being leading into the festive period, where we were having that hope that that was our, in some cases, the last possibility for businesses to be able to, you know, bring some money in, that's now been taken away from them. That's the cause of, you know, the restrictions. So okay. I think we need a reality check on that to see what we can do.
Right. Thanks very much for highlighting that, Liz. Convener, I noticed Matt put a request in on this issue. Thanks, Matt.
Yeah, it was just briefly to say one of the gaps in the hospitality support that the Scottish Government has introduced is student associations. So I'm sure many on the committee may have a fond memory of their student union bar if they spent time as a student. Well, the reality is that student unions are charities and are thus exempt from accessing the hospitality support. So we've been hearing directly that student unions are really suffering financially, not getting that traditional bar income, but aren't necessarily eligible to apply for the support.
Okay, thanks for that, Matt. Thanks, Liz. Thanks. Back to you, Convener.
Thank you, Willie. Could I next turn to Maurice Corry, please, for his questions?
Thank you, Convener. Dr. Cameron, this is for you, this one. Is Scotland's warehouse and delivery network infrastructure coping with the shift to online buying for the festive season?
It is coping right now, but there are gaps appearing, especially after the announcement yesterday. There's opportunities in that area. If we can get more businesses to be able to diversify, you know, the army of taxi drivers, you know, we should be using that resource to fill the gaps out, because this is obviously leading into Christmas. It always was, and always has been a very much growing a business opportunity, because more businesses are putting their stuff online, but we'd like to see more of the small businesses in that regard. So the warehousing, we could be putting quite a lot of the warehousing and the products in offices that are not being utilised right now. They're struggling, but they're going to get through this. Because they're looking other ways of bringing people on to in the short term, because they always did recruit short term employees over the leading into the Christmas season, but that's now increased substantially. And also some retailers who aren't able to open up, they are some already doing it, they're exploring increasing their click and collect service, because that will give them some ray of hope of increasing that opportunity. So click and collect is click and collect, no role to play.
No role to play, did you say?
No, an additional role that will be played leading up to the festive.
But I think this can be seen this season, and also the situation we're in, as an opportunity for those entrepreneurial members of your organisation. So your ideas, Dr. Cameron, are really actually extremely good, because I come from a business background. Have you put those to your members?
You know, have you put this to your members? Interesting question. I haven't actually put it the way I've just presented to you. We are already seeing businesses themselves making that move. There's another number of businesses that are already doing that, because we're quite resilient when we need to be, and we are desperate, so we're looking at every opportunity. A lot of businesses have already done that, going on the moving to more click and collect, moving more stuff online, where they've got the capacity and the competence to do it, looking to the future. And there's also other, we talk about the restaurants, the supply chain, the food suppliers. They are already, there's a great company down in Ayrshire that were already on the creation of food boxes, the creation of, they've already just launched, I think last week, their Christmas in a box idea, and it's your full Christmas dinner being delivered to your home. Just some way of trying to bring a level of some income in. So, we are quite resilient, but as I say, I've not actually put that in the way that I've just presented it to you.
Well, that's good. No, it's a good idea. I think it's something you can put forward. Can I turn to William McLeod in the question of the festive season in relation to the sectors falling through the cracks? Willie, where are the specific sectors that are falling through the cracks, particularly as we come up to festive season, that really rely on that time of the year to make the most of their income?
Well, I think it's probably felt throughout our sector most acutely, I think, at level four, where businesses are closed. And, for example, hotels are restricted to only accommodating essential travellers and essential workers. I think where we're seeing the cracks that will be experienced by businesses are where there are travel restrictions, and where in businesses where customers are less inclined to make, for example, some hotel, even in level three, in level four, Christmas is going to be extremely difficult for them. And there are many hotels have actually closed because they're not seeing forward bookings. There's no anticipation of a buoyant festive period. In the other areas, the restrictions on opening hours are going to have a significant impact as well. And that, if it impacts on businesses, it's also impacting on customers and their ability to do what they would normally be doing at this time of year.
Right. And then on that basis, then, is the support there for them? Are they getting support in their time of need on that basis?
Well, I think, as I perhaps alluded to earlier, I think the government has made available grant support to businesses that are legally obliged to close. I made the point earlier that we don't think that's adequate. I think that there aren't available to businesses that can continue trading. But in many circumstances, the restrictions on trading is such that viability is compromised to the extent that these businesses might as well close anyway, even although they're not legally obliged to do so. So I think it comes down really to the adequacy of the support to meet the costs being incurred by these businesses. Many will have done everything they can to keep their staff on the books, and furlough, the extension of furlough, has really helped with that. but that doesn't actually help with business cash flow, and it doesn't help to meet the remaining fixed costs that these businesses are incurring.
Right. Okay. Thank you for that. Well, that's super. Can I turn to Adam Sakura for the last question? What special communications are you doing over for the festive season amongst your clientele?
Thank you, Maurice. The whole range of things actually going into Christmas, and actually we've been doing throughout this lockdown, have been looking at the Age Scotland helpline was sort of geared up and scaled up back in March to take something more than 10 times its usual level of calls, and actually with support from the Scottish Government to do that. A lot of that was about signposting and referring people to support mechanisms that existed through lockdown and beyond. The level of calls that have been as a result of loneliness and isolation have been increasing massively. We have a friendship line offering, which was developed and properly launched back in June, but really a big focus going into Christmas. And I use Christmas that period sort of through December, January, these particular months. So people can call us, actually. It's a free phone number, 0800 12 44 222. People can just speak to somebody, because actually the people that we're speaking to haven't spoken to people in maybe days and weeks. I spoke to somebody just a couple of months ago, actually, I was the first person they'd spoken to all week, and it's actually quite devastating and heartbreaking to realise that that is the impact. So these communications going out through, you know, media channels, and actually one of the things we're looking at is the support from members of Scottish Parliament, members of Parliament, councillors, to make sure they can disseminate this information to their constituents, and there'll be information about that in very, very due course.
Thank you very much. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you, Maurice. Our next questions come from Annabel Ewing.
Thank you, Convener, and in fact, good afternoon to our panel. And obviously, it's been quite a comprehensive discussion, so I'll try not to duplicate anything. And I would just like to say to all five witnesses to thank you very much for your time today, but indeed to thank you for all that you're doing as well behind the scenes, because I'm sure that your lives have gone from being fairly busy to being exponentially busy, and it is very much appreciated. My first question would be probably to Liz Cameron and to William MacLeod, and perhaps just in that order for broadcasting, they could seek to answer the question. And it is, I mean, I have run a small business in the past. I recognise absolutely the pain that both of you are talking about. I absolutely recognise that, and I have enormous sympathy for that. And I note what you've both said about support, and of course this committee meeting will be being listened to actively and reflected upon. So I think you've both made your points extremely well. Just turning to some broader issues, which I think maybe we haven't really explored. We are in a situation where 11 local authorities in Scotland are at level 4. So 21 are not. But looking around, and I did that last night just to catch up for my own information, where we were, Belgium and France and Italy and Spain and Germany, and things being closed. And indeed, you know, in France, I think you get fined €135 if you leave your home without meeting the requirements of the essential purpose for that. You know, bars closed, restaurants closed. In Belgium, no essential shops, for example. Hotels, you can only have a meal in your room. I mean, so this is something we are seeing right, if we just take Europe, right across Europe. And I understand the frustration. I'm not suggesting I don't, but I just wonder, the frustration really has to be directed at the pandemic that we're in, because surely there's not such a difference in the presenting of the virus in Scotland that we would be in a position to take an entirely different tack to that being taken in many, many other countries across the European Union. And perhaps Liz Cameron could give her thoughts on that, first of all, and then Willie, thanks.
Thank you, Annabel, and thank you for your comments and acknowledging the work that we are all doing. We actually appreciate that comment, so thank you. And I also want to say that, you know, when we're putting forward to government committees, it's not that there's not a blame factor, and that's not when we come forward to some of our comments. So, you know, we're not blaming the Scottish Government for the position that we find ourselves in, because you're absolutely right. This is a global pandemic, and they're and certainly in Europe, you're absolutely right. We've been watching and following France, Germany, and in actual fact, Germany went into its second lockdown way before the United Kingdom actually did, and obviously Scotland as well. So your point is very, very valid in terms of, you know, if we are comparing ourselves with other areas in Europe, what could we have done differently? But then I'm also looking at wider than Europe, and looking at some other countries that probably, hindsight is wonderful, but probably responded quicker and faster than other countries in Europe and elsewhere did. So I think a learning for us in terms of, and that's why we keep pushing, where's our forward plan? Because we were entering in a tunnel that was dark. Nobody knew whether there was any light coming. Nobody knew what was ahead of us. So, you know, I've got to say that, you know, governments and others were very much in a reactive mode. And in some cases, and in some instances right now, we are still reacting. My butt's coming now, and that is that I think that, you know, looking ahead, because learning for me is important and improving where we're at in Scotland is important. We are an exceptionally small nation. Our economy was not as strong as our friends, cousins, colleagues in Europe. So we were behind the ball in Scotland in our economic position. So it means that for us to catch up post-COVID, we need to move faster. And really, I think looking forward, and I know I'm not answering your question direct, but looking forward, let's look at those countries that have brought in mass testing earlier. Let's look at the Liverpool example. Now, that's been criticised by some, you know, only 100,000 or 150,000. So what? It's, you know, I want to see somebody in Scotland to be doing mass testing. If it's an additional pilot, don't care what we call it, but we want mass testing introduced ASAP. The testing issue and that investment in testing, for me, that could have the potential of us getting out of this situation faster, therefore safeguarding our job losses in as much as we, you know, in areas where we can. And I also believe it's much about investing. We're all talking about the vaccine right now, right? You know, is the Scottish Government, do we have our plan? I don't want to wait until other nations in the UK have their plan. You know, have we got a plan now? Is it in place? Can it be shared with our communities so that we understand that the short-term gain now might be even shorter if we have the confidence and the information to say, here's Scotland's vaccine plan. It's going to start on 1st February, and this is how it's going to take place. That in itself could have the potential to change behaviours because we're having to sweep up behaviours right now, and we can't control that. So that's the best answer I can give you.
Thanks, Liz, for that answer. And with regard to the vaccine, I understand that the health secretary will be making a statement to Parliament tomorrow. So I think it's very much watch that space. And turning to Willie, I mean, obviously, having heard what Liz has said, and just the point that was raised earlier about a lot of investment by business, particularly hospitality, in trying to make premises as safe as possible, as practically possible, and that absolutely is recognised. But of course, the virus doesn't really respect that. But having said that, going forward to next year, I mean, you know, we know that we're not going to see our lives go back totally to normal, you know, just by, you know, the vaccine per se. There will be a period of time, I would have thought, realistically, where our lives will be a lot better in terms of freedom, but not quite back to normal. So this investment, I think, is crucial for that period for next year. But looking forward, I know that hospitality and tourism have been looking at a plan for recovery, and it'd be interesting to hear a few key points from Willie on that in terms of key asks that he has that he sees as vital to secure that recovery, which we all want to see next year. Willie.
Thank you. I think can maybe focus on, I think you're referring to the Scottish Tourism Recovery Task Force, which is really an industry-based group that looked at how we might move forward as we cope with the current issues from the pandemic, and how we might move beyond it and retain our competitiveness internationally, which is going to be very important. We've got a very competitive international hospitality industry. Same applies to tourism. And the task force report, I think, is due to be considered by Cabinet later this month or the very early part of December. And that contains a wide range of recommendations about as recover, helping business and looking at future investment levels. Importantly, I think, looking at how we stimulate demand. And some of the issues in there are as broad as how do we best resource in Scotland, visit Scotland, how do we best resource visit Britain to promote our countries to the international marketplace, to get international tourism to return. That's all but collapsed. It's collapsed because of international confidence levels. It's collapsed because of the problems the aviation industry is facing. So I think to be able to offer a safe product, a safe service to both domestic and international consumers is going to be important. In addition to supporting our own industry, which is my job, we really have to support the aviation industry and get the ability of people to travel back as near normal as possible. And I think that's going to depend a lot on testing and testing at airports. I hope we're not laying too much store by a vaccine, but if we can get an effective vaccine and we get effective vaccine arrangements globally, then that will hasten our return to normal. But I don't think anybody's anticipating a return to normal in the near future. Our own estimates are that it's going to be well into 2022. Before we see businesses recovering. I also hear of the difficulties of the inbound travel trade, the tour operators and the destination management companies that are an important part of our supply chain, bringing international visitors to the country. And I'm hearing harrowing tales about how their turnover has dropped, and they're not anticipating anything of a recovery until the second quarter of next year. So, I would really urge the Scottish Government and all politicians to have a look at this recovery task force and move at pace to implement the recommendations. Having said that, we recognise that money doesn't grow on trees and that there will have to be priorities decided.
Yes, thank you, Willie, indeed, for that very comprehensive answer. There are indeed many, many issues to be looked at with regard to hospitality and tourism, particularly. If I could ask just one more question, if I may, convener, and that would be to Maureen, who I think I've just seen on the screen. And I appreciate the other panellists, but the questions I was going to ask both Matt and Adam have actually been answered, so colleagues have done the job there. But to Maureen, can I just ask, you know, the very important issues that Maureen has raised about faith groups and the importance of that to people's lives and all the various festivals we're seeing coming up and that in fact have been happening under restriction. You know, obviously these are really important issues that Maureen has referred to. And you know, whilst we're looking, you know, we've done a lot of talk about Christmas, which is important for Christians and non-Christians alike. I just wonder, you know, there have been calls, for example, for a 24-hour armistice in churches and so forth. I just wonder, in terms of the discussions and the planning that is going on in the amongst the interfaith group, what concretely kind of ideas are you coming forward with that you could put to government that may meet the safety, overarching safety considerations? What ideas do you have in that regard to make that work, Maureen?
Thank you. Thank you very much for your question, Annabelle. Just in a little kind of look back for a second, if that's okay, because I think one of the things that Interfaith Scotland did was an online festival just last week, which was Scottish Interfaith Week. And it was really to lift the spirits of faith communities, interfaith groups, organisations and, you know, people engaging with the festival, which had the theme of connecting. And I think that's a really huge theme in relationship to what faith communities do. They connect with their parishioners, for want of a better word, you know, whether it's through the mosque, the gurdwara, the synagogue, and the churches, they stay connected with people. And it's been mentioned a number of times, I've been listening really intently, about behaviours and the way that people behave. And I think the messaging that faith communities can get out to the literally, you know, 2.5 million people that they represent, if half the population are, you know, deem themselves as affiliated with a religious tradition, then I think they have a very powerful role to play in helping people to abide by behaviours that are really helpful for the country going forward, you know, in terms of just keeping people safe. But there's also very simple things that have been done already by the government, and I think that should be continuing. For example, Interfaith Scotland has managed a small grant fund to allow places of worship, which remember, are getting less income than usual because they've not had people going there. But they want to stay open to enable that community connection. So they have a small grant fund in order to do the whole cleaning of these vast buildings appropriately, to have in place PPE, hand sanitization, fear signposting, all of that kind of thing. And there's also a community safety fund, because again, when places, buildings are lying empty, vandalism and all that kind of thing can take place, and that's been rolled out as well. So there's a lot that is already being done. But in terms of what the Interfaith Scotland and the faith communities can do, I think messaging and behaviour are the key things. You know, get the messages out to these communities. I mean, there's evidence, isn't there, that the BAME community are negatively impacted by COVID. So getting the messages out to the, particularly the minority faith communities, where the majority the Black and ethnic minority communities engage with their faith communities. So getting the messages out clearly, I think, is really, really important. And just a tiny little touch on travel, because travel has been mentioned. One of the things about Christmas and perhaps all festivals is that people travel to their families, they travel to their places of worship. And how is the mess, if we don't go out, say, for example, of level four in the Central Belt, how do we message about, you know, you're not going to be with your family at Christmas if your family happen to be in levels tier three, tier two, tier one? You know, thinking about what was all that was being said about the students, that just applies widely, really, to those in particular tiers. And there will be this huge cultural expectation that people will be together at the festival period. You know, Hanukkah, Christmas particularly, I think, come to mind. And so dealing with that disappointment, if it's not going to happen, you know, what is that going to be like? And also, I think I just want to mention very briefly, although it's a tiny bit, not too far off, is that, you know, Scotland is actually a very wealthy nation in compared to, you know, the majority. I think we're the 14th wealthiest in the world. So there is wealth. And I was really stunned to hear about the kind of wealth that is available to the multinationals, for example, and the huge increases in their profits. And although there might have been a little bit of resistance to say how could that be redistributed, I think faith communities have always had a heart for the poor and the vulnerable. It's very much the reason d'etre of, you know, the thinking about ensuring that there's a quality of treatment and a quality of access to things, and just to be fair to people. And I do wonder about, is there something that could be done with this? I think it's extreme excess. And there must be a way of redistributing that in a fair way that doesn't negatively impact on their business in a huge way. Which, I mean, if they're making profits of, was it 560 odd million pounds, whereas small businesses are suffering, there's some imbalance, and perhaps the Christian community is the prophetic voice of religion, is that, you know, something's out of balance. And how do we rebalance that and give people a fair access to the wealth that is there in Scotland? I mean, there's no doubt if we're the 14th wealthy nation, somebody somewhere's got that wealth. And that redistribution and looking at that, I think, is also really important. Thank you for your question, Annabelle.
Thank you, Maureen. And you end on a very thought-provoking proposition, which I'm sure is also being listened to carefully presumably also including in our finance team in the Scottish Government. Thank you.
Thank you for that. Our final questions come from Shona Robertson.
Thank you, Convener. Most of my questions have been asked, but I want to pick up on Dr. Steer's final point there. Understandably, and we all understand the frustrations of business and the challenges that business are facing, and Liz and Willie in particular have talked understandably about the need for more resources for those businesses that are struggling, particularly small businesses. But Willie also made the point about money doesn't grow on trees. And therefore, it really is to come back, particularly to Liz Cameron, to perhaps push her on the point that Mark Ruskell had made earlier, and that is, surely it can't be right that when we look at recovery and who pays for that, that that can't all fall on individual taxpayers. There has to be a proportionate contribution from those large corporations that have made the most money during this pandemic. Now, I understand, you know, she represents a number of organisations and might be reluctant to come out explicitly for that, but it would be interesting to know two things. One is, what does she think her the small business members of the Chamber would think about that as a way of perhaps supporting their recovery going forward? And would she be willing to maybe canvass the members of her organisation around, you know, that balance of who pays going forward? I'd be interested to hear her comments about that.
Now, first of all, your question about, you know, first of all, have we or will I canvass our members on that? That sharing of wealth, let me put it that way, and that equality that surrounds that, because it's been an agenda item that has is out there for a wee while, and it's becoming higher up the priority list. One end of it, you know, corporates would say that are making all these millions, and others making lots of money. Would say that, well, I'm paying already, I pay that, as I said, through my corporation tax. That's a view. So just stick with me in a moment on that. That is a view. And they would also probably, if they were sitting here, say to the committee that we also contribute greatly to our communities in a variety of ways, whether that's through creating jobs, maintaining jobs, supporting our employees in lots of ways, supporting communities, supporting charities. The list could be starting and could start and stop quite long in that regard. There's something here that they would also say that they are, and a lot of them are already doing that, they are developing and supporting through supply chain, creating by local campaigns, and you know, making certain their supply chain is actually coming more from local suppliers, which help small businesses, which in turn help them to build their businesses up. But I will actually take that on board, Shona, to ask that question and put that out. How do corporates feel about that in general terms? And you know, as I said in my response, I think it's a conversation to be had. But I'm always one for encouraging and engaging and working in partnership for the greater good of Scotland's communities, because local chambers are a central lever for local communities. So although we represent business, we also represent third sector and a number of other organisations, and we contribute greatly to our communities. So that's worth a discussion. I will take that away to ask that question, and you know, as I say, enter into that discussion as we move forward, because there is something there. But whether it's you know, a one-liner on, you know, tax bans, whether, you know, corporates that earn X amount over a profitable, you know, margin, a proportion of that should go to X, Y, and Z. Interesting concept, and worth a discussion. Find out whether, you know, is that the best way forward to grow our economy in totality, or indeed whether such a potential move, if we're talking about, you know, new tax bans, would that impact on investment coming into Scotland? Question mark. Would that impact on the competitiveness of businesses in Scotland? Question mark. So there's a lot in that question, and I know I've not came and answered direct yes or no. I've said a discussion to be had. I will canvass, because we need to, if we are looking in that direction of travel, we need to consider very, very carefully the impacts both positively and potentially negatively.
Can I thank Liz Cameron for her positive response? These are absolutely the big discussion items that we all have to have. And, you know, I would recognise what she said about some big businesses have been protecting the local supply chain and looking after their staff, but not all have done that. And I would just want to put on the record there's been big differences in how companies have responded to the pandemic, particularly in regard to their workforce. Convener, that's all from me. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I just had one last question. It's really for Dr. Maureen Sear, which is just for your reflections on places of worship over the festive period. Given that, you know, in normal course, these are very busy with a lot of people attending services, and obviously it slightly depends where we are at that stage of restrictions. But do you have any observations? I note your computer appears to have frozen, so you may not be able to answer this, but I'd just be interested in just your closing reflections on that, if you are still online. If not, we can leave it. Can you hear me? Can you hear me, Dr. Sear? I don't think you can. All right. Well, listen, we'll leave it. Perhaps we might catch up on that offline. Can I thank all the witnesses for their evidence and for giving us their time this morning. That concludes our meeting. The clerks will advise members of the arrangements for our next meeting next week in due course. And I now close the meeting. Can I just finish by expressing my grateful thanks to all our witnesses on the panel today. That was a really interesting session. Thank you again, and I close the meeting.